This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial.
Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water, then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Otrigger. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Thank you very much, Fred Foy, and hello, everybody. Welcome to another edition of The Glowing Dial, that most fantabulous old-time radio program you're ever going to want to hear anywhere. I am Big John Matthews, your warm, rotund host, and sitting over there in that sort of direction again. I know you can't see where I'm pointing, but I don't care. I get something, it sticks in my brain, and I keep doing it.
Yeah, yeah. Q-tips are good for that.
Gotta change it up every now and again, don't I?
Yeah, yeah.
Mr. Stu Chisholm, hello, sir.
Yes, filling in for Steve. How you doing?
I'm doing good. And on behalf of all our listeners and everybody else that we know, I'd like to wish you a happy birthday.
Why, thank you, thank you.
Got you coming up on August the 7th.
That's right.
You're going to be, what, 23, 24?
Yeah.
Somewhere in there?
Yeah, for about the 30th. Time. yep, going to be the big 5'8".
Yeah, there's no keeping it secret because you said what year you were born in the last episode, so...
Yeah, I don't give a crap. I'm not a girl.
I never did understand why women are hung up about that.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's the way other people think about you when you get to a certain age, but, you know, like I say, I don't give a crap. I'm, you know, I'm employed, I'm self-employed, I'm married, I don't care. I don't care what people think. There you go.
There you go. Well, to celebrate your birthday,
yes,
all four of the programs in this episode are going to be from August 7th.
Yay.
All of them before you were born, so.
Shout out to all the Leos. Yeah.
You mean the lion from MGM?
Okay. Yeah, him too.
Yeah.
I ain't lying.
And Leo Adler. Remember him?
Oh, sure. Leo DiCaprio. Yeah.
Leo Adler, used car dealer in the Detroit area.
Yeah, we try not to. Remember, that's one of those evil commercials.
But it's still in your brain.
Yeah, I know.
You know, that's as bad as some of these commercials are. They stick in your brain, and that's probably what they're designed to do.
I was going to say they did their job.
Even those annoying, those ones with the annoying announcers, you know, that
like all of them.
Just about Billy Mays was at the top of the list there, you know. But
I hate are the Empire Carpet ones. It's like, okay, come on, make a new jingle for crying out loud.
It sounds like it's from the 50s.
It does. They even started tacking on, I remember when they started tacking on, today. You know, so you hear Empire and then you go, today. Letting you know that they're not like closed and this isn't some anomalous, spurious old commercial.
What about the Belvedere Home Improvement song? Yeah, you remember that one?
Yeah. Yep. Bye-bye, paintbrush.
We do good work.
Yep.
And unless you're a Detroiter, you're probably not going to understand a lot of these references we're throwing out here.
But, yeah, we Michiganians are rather parochial, I'm afraid. Sorry.
Yeah. But enough about that. We're celebrating Stu's birthday here.
Yes.
And we're going to get started with our first program right after this important message. Perhaps the funniest series ever on radio is now available in a 14 CD limited edition package. That's all 273 episodes, plus bonus material. Yes, available at last. The complete story of Chicken Man. This is the ultimate collector's package, mastered from the original master tapes by Dick Orkin, Chicken Man's creator and voice. Aside from every Chicken Man episode ever made, this package includes interviews with key players, behind-the-scenes stories, and an official color photo, personally autographed by Chicken Man himself. And each limited edition package is individually numbered. A very naughty criminal mastermind, now a reformed swell guy, says of our hero,
"The most fantastic crime fighter the world has ever known."
An anonymous admirer says,
"He's poultry in motion."
By now, you're probably asking yourself, how the heck can I get one of these neato packages? Well, simply hop online and go to glowingdial.com. Scroll down and you'll see the magnificent No Expense Spared advertisement and ordering link. Remember, this is a limited edition numbered package, so you better hurry up and order. If you don't, you might miss out. And then all I can say is, well... And we're back. It's time for our first birthday episode, celebrating Stu's birthday.
Ta-da!
This is Command Performance, and it's with special guest star Greer Garson. It's from Saturday, August 7th, 1943, over the Armed Forces Radio Service. And along with Greer Garson, we have Gloria Warren, Nelson Eddy, Cass Daly, Pinto Kovig, and Bill Bletcher. We also have the 43rd Army Air Forces Orchestra from Gardner Field. And Ken Carpenter is announcing. Standing by now with a little bit of information and background on Command Performance is Stu.
Yes, Command Performance is a radio program which originally aired between 1942 and 1949, which means the show was out of production like 8 years before I was born. But this was from August 7th. The program was broadcast on the Armed Forces Radio Network, AFRS, with a direct shortwave transmission to the troops overseas. It was not broadcast over the domestic U.S. radio stations, so nah nah to mainlanders. Troops sent in requests for a particular performer or a program to appear, and they also suggested unusual ideas for music and sketches for the program, such as Ann Miller tap dancing in military boots. Top performers of the day appeared, including Jack Benny, Frank Sinatra, Bob Hope, Fred Allen, Ginger Rogers, Judy Garland, and the Andrews Sisters, who I absolutely adore. One memorable program, a 55-minute musical adaptation of Dick Tracy, was broadcast on February 15, 1945. Bing Crosby had the title role in Dick Tracy in B-flat, with Dinah Shore as Tess Trueheart and Jimmy Durante as the Mole. The solos must have been fantastic. The supporting cast included Judy Garland, Cass Daly, Frank Sinatra, Frank Morgan, Bob Hope, Harry Von Zell, Jerry Colonna, Lou Crosby, and the Andrews Sisters, and the Joe Lilly Chorus. The program generally ran for 30 minutes outside the holiday and other specials, continuing well after World War II for a total of more than 400 programs, and today we'll give you 0.25% of them.
Oh, yeah. The aforementioned 55-minute special, Dick Tracy in B-flat, was featured on The Glowing Dial a short time ago, and you can find that in the Glowing Dial archives.
Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba, hello, 6-2 and even, ba-ba-ba-ba. I can't imagine him as Dick Tracy, sorry. Just...
Well, it was a comedy, comedy musical take on it, you know.
I kind of imagined with all the singing and stuff.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But the thing about Command Performance and shows of that ilk that were done for the armed forces, like Here's to Veterans and other shows like that. Mail Call was another one. All
Without
the celebrities.
Arlie Ermey.
Yeah. All the, I got that. All the celebrities gave their services free of charge.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, kind of like the USO.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And somewhere on the internet, there's a little film. It was probably shown in theaters, but a little film of them actually doing, I think it was a Mail Call. It featured Groucho Marx, and it had Abbott and Costello doing their Who's on First routine.
Oh, yeah.
And instead of I don't give a darn is I don't give a damn.
Ooh.
Lou said, I don't give a damn.
Ooh, risque. And
yeah, it was. And
frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn.
And you can see it on the film. You see Abbott kind of like...
flinch, yeah.
Yeah, a little bit.
They were always trying to mess with each other, too. I mean, that's a fun part.
I don't know that the censorship was as heavy with the armed forces that it was with the standard networks. Of course, no commercials were allowed.
I have to imagine your basic soldier heard a little bit of colorful language.
Yeah. Well, back in the time, just Lou saying, I don't give a damn, you know, was...
Yep.
Oh, he said damn.
More, and he more wasn't colorful talking about metaphors, Hoover. Captain?
And he wasn't talking about Hoover.
Yeah.
One damn it, Admiral.
Yeah, and a double dumbass on you, too.
Yes, rest in peace, Leonard Nimoy. We shall miss you, sir.
Yep.
All right, it's time to get this episode tuned in. Now, what we're going to have to do on the McGee machine is there's a switch right there, which switches it over from regular band to the Armed Forces band.
Oh, okay. All right. I wondered if that was a switch or if the machine was just happy to see me.
No, that's a switch.
Okay. It's a large one. I'm impressed.
So you don't miss it.
Okay.
We put the large switch in there, so, you know.
Yeah, with my eyesight, that's a good idea.
And I kept breaking my nail on the small one.
Okay.
There you go.
We got it.
All right.
Is it working? The little light's on.
It's working. All right. So, as the McGee machine works, I'm going to tell you to sit back, close your eyes, and remember the command performance. This is with special guest star Greer Garrison from Saturday, August 7th, 1943, originally over the Armed Forces Radio Service.
Happy birthday to me.
USA, the greatest entertainers in America, as requested by you, the fighting men of the United States Armed Forces throughout the world. Command Performance, presented this week and every week, till it's over there. Okay there, gang, it's Command Performance time at all battle stations of the AEF and the United Nations. So all of you guys who are spending full time knocking off the Axis, let's knock off that international half hour where the Hollywood stars knock out the answers to your letters to Command Performance Special Service, Los Angeles, USA. Those letters are the magic key to the music and laughter of America. So whatever you want, brother, just write it down and we'll get it for you. And here, an answer to letters from all over the earth, is your commanding officer of Command Performance tonight, 1943's beautiful Academy Award winner, Greer Garrison.
Thank you, Ken Carpenter. And hello, fellows. You've heard all about the big radio networks that link New York with San Francisco, that link Little Turkey Junction, Iowa, with Bumblebee, Arizona. But you're tuned in to the biggest network of them all, a network that links each one of you with your loved ones here at home. I'm sure, too, that you've heard of the famous Chinese theater in Hollywood, where the stars have placed their footprints in the blocks of cement. Well, tonight, Command Performance is like that theater, with all the footprints filled, a star-packed GI double feature jammed into a half hour. For example, here come 36 guest stars to start things off. The 43rd Army Air Forces Orchestra of Gardner Field playing I Know That You Know.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, fellows, I think it's high time that we do something about this letter from Nicky Rossetti, a former Pittsburgh bookkeeper who used to keep track of charge accounts, but who now keeps track of depth charges on North Atlantic convoy duty. Nicky puts it this way. Dear Command Performance, there's a terrific guy named Pinto Colvig of the animated cartoons. Sorry, Pinto. Thank him for bringing us the voices of Pluto and Goofy on the show a few months ago, but tell him that now we'd like to have him come up with his famous old battered-up trombone and do his imitation of the old Model T car. Okay, Nicky, it's another command performance for Pinto Colvig.
Thank you, Gear Garson, and hiya, fellas. I got my old battered-up trombone here, and it is battered up and good and brassy, and I paid $2 for it in a hawk shop down here in Los Angeles a few years ago and got a case cost $17.50. Fits in, and I've used this thing in about 300 animated cartoons representing everything from washing machines and electric razors and every kind of a thing you can imagine. But a few years ago, Jack Benny called me up and he said he'd like to have me work out the original sound effects for the old Maxwell car. So I brought the trombone along, and the way it's done, you just pour your naked lip down in here and you just let her flicker. Here we go, step on the star.
Whoa, 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 whoa.
Thank you, Pinto Colvig. Every day when we sneak down to the corner mailbox, we find letters to command performance from faraway places that still keep us running through our world map. And it's a rare day indeed that old Sam the mailman doesn't drop off a special batch for Nelson Eddy. So let's put this popular man to work. Front and center, Nelson Eddy.
Thank you, Greg Garson. I'm giving the mail a rapid whirl. I'm saying hi to Corporal High Baraban up there in Greenland. Thanks to you good folks in Australia for your friendly letters. Hello, Virgil E. Blanton at Navy Mobile Hospital No. 4. And greetings, Corporal H.H. McQueen in the mob at 928. And brother, get a load of these nicknames on the letter from Norman Dunn at 503. Handlebar, Harriman, Bumblefoot, Butler, Mob Billings, and Papa Godek. Dehydrated Feeney, Squint Duckworth, Pretty Boy Sarah, Chowhound O'Connor, Fallen Archer's Mazza, and Sunkissed. And we used to think the Gold Rush produced colorful names. Well, anyway, for Pat, Bill, Steve, Guy, and Red at 709, here's the song all of you go for. I think it's a good theme song for the whole AEF. Stout-hearted men.
Dreams, if you act, they will come true. To turn your dreams to a fact, it's up to you. If you have the soul and the spirit, never fear it, you'll see it through. Thoughts can inspire other hearts with their fire, for the strong obey when a strong man shows them the way. Give me some men who are stout-hearted men who will fight for the right they adore.
Are three with ten who are stout-hearted men, and I'll soon give you 10,000 more. Shoulder to shoulder, and bolder, they grow as they go to the fore. And there's nothing in the world can halt or mar a plan. When stout-hearted men can stick together, man to man. And bolder and bolder they grow as they go to the fore. When there's nothing in the world can halt or mar a plan. When stout-hearted men can stick together, man to
Eddie, that was grand. Fellows, let's take just a second to answer this letter. It's from G.I. Joe Anonymous at Dutch Harbor. Dear Command Performance, in the Richmond district of San Francisco, there was an old fruit peddler with an accent and the loudest voice in America. All he sold was apples, oranges, and bananas. Ask anybody in Frisco. They'll know him. And please, just let me hear that yell of his again. Okay, Joe. We checked with our Golden Gate office, and here's the call of that fruit peddler.
Apples, oranges, bananas.
Well, that certainly didn't take long, did it? As a lot of you know, we get so many letters on Command Performance that ask for the song, You're Always in My Heart. Rob Dixon, speaking for the Hell Drivers in that motor pool at 954, says, That song means very much to me and my buddies, and nothing would please us more than to hear it on our own show, Command Performance. But it's got to be sung by Gloria Warren. And this seems to be the favorite combination of Private Jack Roberts at 860 and the Red Legs at 961. And there's an army nurse here and there who writes to us of someone who is always in her heart. So next on the agenda, this favorite song of thousands of you, sung by Gloria Warren.
You are always in my heart.
Now, I'm checking in next with APO 957 and those big-time operators from Kentucky and Indiana with such fine, dignified titles as Box, Red Rider, Sock, Load, and Dirty Pete. Also, Sarge Del Cajan. Is that how you pronounce it, Sarge? And the 9th Marines. Our love, too, to the tankers who helped wind up that job in Tunisia. And a special kiss to three more Marines who call themselves the Bunch on the Rock. Tony, Bill, and Stinky. And our very best to the aerial gunners in Ward 17 at 647. My goodness, fellows. So many of you signed that letter that I can't mention every one. But speedy recovery to Shorty Danish, Chubby Byers, Dingy Lewis, the Brooklyn Bull, and the whole workshop. And especially for you, but for the whole AEF too, Command Performance presents one of your real favorites, that madcap comedian of the Paramount lot, Cass Daly.
Oh, thank you, Miss Garson, and hi, fellas. Gee, Miss Garson, it's a real thrill for me to be up here with you. Gosh, you're beautiful.
Why, thank you, Cass.
Gee, I sure wish I could look as beautiful as you.
Oh, Cass, well, that doesn't matter anyhow. Beauty is only external. It's what you have beneath that counts.
I know, but I already gave mine to the scrap drive.
Oh, now, Cass. No, Cass, you've got nothing to be ashamed of. Take away Betty Grable's legs and Hedy Lamarr's eyes and Lana Turner's figure, and what have you got?
Me. But really, Miss Garson, I must tell you how much I enjoyed your picture work, especially Ransom Harvest.
What did
Random
you...
Harvest.
You sure you meant that one? I mean, you did like Random Harvest?
Yes, I loved it. Well, I liked it. Say, every week I went down to the San Diego Naval Base and I played Random Harvest with the sailors.
Well, you mean you play Random Harvest with the sailors?
Yeah. I pick them at random and you should see what I harvest.
Now, wait a minute, Cass, wait a minute. Haven't you a young gentleman friend who objects?
Oh, I'll say I have. I go around with one of the cutest little characters you've ever seen.
Oh, is it love?
It certainly is.
Cass, what does your dream man look like?
Well, have you ever seen a short beer with legs?
That chap sounds like he's got a head on him.
Oh. Not only that, he's got a heart of gold and a mouth full of samples.
Well, I bet he's a very entertaining young man.
Hmm? Certainly is. Every night he comes over to the house and we sit on the sofa and turn the lights down low and takes off his shoes and then he starts there for 3 hours wriggling his toes and...
3 hours? What do you mean, wriggling his toes?
Sure. He's not the kind of a guy that sits around doing nothing.
I think maybe you better sing, Cass.
Okay. Fellas, here's a little aria I'm doing in my next picture called Lament of a Lonely Girl. Sexy, ain't it? Van Gertz, I iron shirts till my fingers hurt. When my fingers hurt, it drives me nuts. I'm Steely Van Gertz, I iron shirts. I come in the morning, take off my hat. I mind my business, I never chat. I wet in the wet and flat in the flat. I flat in the flat till it's flat. That's that. that's bound to stick your blue. So tear off all the buttons, rip up your underwear to pieces, wash your husband's sweaters and make them sleeveless blue. My boss, Mr. Finch, he gives me a pinch. He gives me a pinch, my boss, Mr. Finch. He tries to clinch, I don't give an inch.
I know what to do in a pinch, Mr. Finch.
We park by the road, just him and me. The moon is high and so is he. He gets ideas and so do I. So what do? I club the guy. I've got those total unemployment. Ain't got a dime to even live on. Where the dickens am I gonna get the rent from Blue? I've got those timeless stony pavements. Both of my feet, they burn like fire. Just can't get me a job for some decent wages, Blue. This unemployment leaves a dent. Now I'm broke, badly bent. Not a cent to pay the rent. What should I do?
Live in a tent?
I needed some work, was gone berserk. Met my boss. Hello, said the... Dope. He said, come now, forget our row. Come back to your job, I'll be good, I vow. I got the shallow, let him kiss me. Should I accept and take my chances with the things I might have to contend with? Daily blues. I've got those, I'm in a dilemma. Being I need a job so badly, shall I live in a quandary or work in a laundry blues? Holy gee, I'm in a pickle. I guess I'll have to toss a nickel. Should I will? Should I won't? No coaching, please. Heads I do, tails I don't.
I'll take head.
You'll take what I got.
I'm Seely Van Gertz. I iron shirts till my fingers hurt. When my fingers hurt, it drives me nerd. I'm Seely Van Gertz. I iron shirts.
At least I'll eat 3 meals a day.
Thank you, Cass Daly. That was grand. I wish you could have seen her, boys. Skipping around the world now for a second, I'd like to drop off a hello to Hattie C. Muller at 851. And I'm thinking of two little girls in England named Betty and Joan of Guildford, Surrey. And special greetings to APO 762, 922, and 928. To the crowd in Puerto Rico, Hawaii, and the stalwart men of Midway. Our best to wink and blink and a nod with the British Army in India. Speaking of the British, we're very proud of a letter from Blondie Bill Stokes, care of GPO, London. Bill says, command performance clears away the monotony of tropical afternoons. I bet it does. It's a great show for the great American boys. After we clean out the Nazis together, I'll hop a transport with them and visit you folks in the States. Thank you, Bill Stokes. And that goes for every fighting man of Britain. And for the fighting men and women of all the United Nations, here's another command performance by your great favorite, Nelson Eddy, singing Oh, What a Beautiful Morning from the play Oklahoma.
There's a bright golden haze haze on the meadow. There's a bright golden haze on the meadow. The corn is as high as an elephant's eye, and it looks like it's climbing clear up to the sky. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I got a beautiful feeling. Everything's going my way. Oh, the cattle are standing like statues. Oh, the cattle are standing like statues. They don't turn their heads as they see me ride, boy. But a little brown maverick is a winking her eye. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I got a beautiful music. All the sounds of the earth are like music. The breeze is so busy, it don't miss a tree. And a weeping willer is laughing at me. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. Going my way. Oh, what a beautiful, oh, what a beautiful, oh, what a beautiful day.
Well, men, this is Greer Garson speaking from America. I've never sat in a barracks room in Newfoundland and heard that word come out of a radio. I've never braced myself against the wall of a rolling battleship and heard the word America jump across an ocean to beat against my heart. But somehow, I know what it means to you and what it does to you. Maybe it's something like pulling into the hometown station, looking out the train window and seeing your mother standing there. Hearing the word America near an airfield on Munda, on an oil tanker in the Arctic Circle, must be a mixture of happiness and pain. Often those two, pain and happiness, are one thing, aren't they? Like when women cry because they're so happy. Why do we speak of this? I'll tell you. Because of men like you, who are ready to give back to this country all that it has given you, we too have found a new and greater meaning in the word America. And now, fellows, thanks for your company. And to each and every one of you over there, love and good luck from the USA.
This is Ken Carpenter with a closing notation that music tonight came from the 43rd Army Air Forces Orchestra of Gardner Field. And the command performance, arranged in cooperation with the Hollywood Victory Committee, is produced for you men of the Armed Forces of the United Nations by the Special Service Division of the War Department of the United States of America.
Hi, I'm singer Betty Johnson, and you're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
We're back with you, folks. You just heard Command Performance with special guest star Greer Garson. That's from Saturday, August the 7th, 1943, originally over the Armed Forces Radio Service. And we have three more shows to bring you and celebration of Stu's birthday. They were all broadcast on August 7th of different years, of course. And we're going to get to that. But right now we have some other business to take care of. We're also doing a celebratory thing in a different way. We have some other birthdays other than yours that we're going to have you read
but,
off
but
there.
But some fortunate people who are also Leos.
Yes, maybe not as important as you, of course.
That's,
you know,
that's true.
But we're still celebrating that they have lived and what they accomplished in their life. And the Candru sisters are over there in the corner.
Uh-oh.
Gathered around their single mic, ready to go. All right, ladies, are you ready? Then take it away. Ladies and gentlemen, once more on the Glowing Dial, it is time for the celebrity birthday list, and here with the thankless, arduous task that he loves doing so much is Mr. Stu Chisholm. Take it away, sir.
Why, thank you. This is for August 2nd through August 22nd. If you celebrate a birthday on August 2nd, then you share your birthday with Hal Block, writer and panelist from Burns and Allen and the Milton Berle Show and What's My Line? On the 3rd is Irene Tedrow's birthday, actress from Meet Corliss Archer and Chandu the Magician. On August the 4th, it's Wally Mayer's birthday from One Man's Family and the Adventures of Nero Wolfe. On 8-5, Parley Bear's birthday is being celebrated, actor from Gunsmoke and Rogers of the Gazette. On the day before my birthday, August 6th, that's Jack Kirkwood's birthday from Saunders of the Circle X and Hawthorne House. Then on August 7th is me. And I also share that birthday with Ernestine Wade from the actors from Amos and Andy. And, you know, seeing as I'm taking some liberties here, I also want to point out that August 7th is the birthday of talented yet evil hockey player Sidney Crosby. Sidney being a rival of my beloved Detroit Red Wings. It's also baseball player Mike Trout's birthday. And more of you might know the actress Charlize Theron, who is celebrating her birthday the same as me. Isn't that cool? Okay, moving on from August 7th is August 8th. Still time to buy a gift, by the way, belated. Nat Pendleton from Dr. Kildare celebrates his birthday on the 8th. On the 9th is Don Bernard from the director Blondie, Life of Riley, and Meet Mr. Meek. Jeff Corey's birthday is on the 10th, actor in Nightbeat and Escape. And then Burn Suri is celebrating on the 11th, sound effects for Suspense, Whistler, and Sam Spade. Joe Besser, the comedian from Jack Benny program and the Three Stooges, celebrates a birthday on August 12th. And if yours is August 13th, then Skinny Ennis is your birthday co-celebrator, band leader and singer from Bob Hope and Abbott and Costello Show. Then on the 14th, it's Nehemiah Persoff's birthday. Who? Nehemiah Persoff, Hollywood radio theater actor. Then on the 15th, Sam Perrin's birthday is being celebrated, the writer from the Jack Benny program and the Phil Baker Show. And if your birthday's on the 16th, Mae Clark shares it with you, the actress from Family Theater. This is your FBI and Lux Radio Theater. On the 17th is Monty Woolley's birthday from the Magnificent Montague. On the 18th is Benjamin Abrams, co-founder of Emerson Radio. Franz Stryker, the creator and writer of The Lone Ranger, Sergeant Preston of the Yukon, and The Green Hornet, celebrating on the 19th. On the 20th is Alan Reed from The Fred Allen Show, Life with Luigi, and Ken Carpenter on the 21st, and David Victor on the 22nd.
I didn't think you were going to make it.
I kind of took some liberties. I didn't mention Alan Reed, you know, the who also was the voice of Fred Flintstone.
Yabba-dabba-doo.
I was going to throw that in there.
Yes.
And Ken Carpenter from Edgar Bergen and Charlie McCarthy Show. Didn't want to give him short shrift. And finally, I skipped over David Victor being from the writer from the Joan Davis time and Let George Do It and the Mel Blanc Show. Kind of big cred for a writer there.
Yeah, that was Mel Blanc's show was an interesting show. I mean, kind of funny, but typical as a sitcom, and you know, spotlighted some of Mel's different voices. But it wasn't. I don't know that he carried a show on his own quite as good as he was when he was with Jack Benny.
Oh, and for
doing his Warner characters, you know.
And by the way, actor David Mann celebrates his birthday August 7th too.
Oh, wow!
Nothing but cool people, except for David Crosby. I'm kidding. I mean, Sidney Crosby, rather. David Crosby's cool. Sidney Crosby, he gives my Red Wings a lot of headaches.
That's no relation to Bing, I'm assuming, there.
You know, I wouldn't know. it's not out of the question, really.
There's not too many guys around now called Sidney anymore, you know? That's just not a name that's very popular.
No, that's true. It's kind of a quaint, archaic kind of name for a guy.
There are some names out there that I think parents should be shot for giving kids such names.
Well, I know
some of
that,
them are just stupid.
I know that Sidney is one of those transgender, well, not transgender, but cross-gender names.
Depending on how you spell it, yeah.
You remember Sidney Biddle Sparrow. Okay, you might not to remember that name for why, but she was a rather attractive woman. So there you go. Hey, you know, Alfalfa celebrates his birthday the same day as me, Carl Switzer.
Okay.
David Duchovny?
Mulder.
Not too bad, huh? Yeah.
Let me Mulder that over for a minute.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And Tobin Bell. Bell.
Saw films, right?
Yeah, he's a little bit older than me, though. He's 72. And, of course, I'm a DJ, and so is Samantha Ronson, and we're both celebrating our birthdays on August 7th.
Okay, well, more birthdays than you just wanted to know here in the
there
Glowing Dial this time
I'm
around.
Like that.
Wait till we get around to mine.
back around. You just passed yours not too much, a couple of months ago.
Yeah.
Well, let's see. That'll be more like 3 months ago by the time this airs.
Yeah, I don't know if we're going to do this, you know, every show aired on your birthday thing every single time. Because it's hard to find shows.
No, I appreciate the extra effort. you can instead, you know, just substitute large gifts next time.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, we have three more shows to get to, but we're going to take time out for this important message first.
Hi, Big John here to tell you about the greatest internet experience you'll ever have. And I'm talking about the Glowing Dial page. And to get there, all you have to do is simply point your browser to www.glowingdial.com. It couldn't be any easier. The Glowing Dial page is the internet presence for our old-time radio show, The Glowing Dial. There are so many things to see and do at the Glowing Dial page, we don't have time to list them all. But here's a few. Read mini bios of Steve, Stu, and myself and find out how the show came to be. Enter our latest contest and win a neat prize. Visit the photo gallery and view images of myself, Stu, and Steve, as well as some of our friends and OTR celebrities, too. Stop in the Glowing Dial bookstore through our association with Amazon.com. Subscribe to our new podcast and also enjoy classic episodes of the Glowing Dial. You can also subscribe to our blog and discussion list and keep up with all the latest Glowing Dial news and information. Stop by the Glowing Dial online store and purchase a wide variety of items emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo. All that and more awaits you at the Glowing Dial page at www.glowingdial.com. See you there!
And we're back, and it's time for our next episode. It's an episode of Life with Luigi, and it's called A Date with Shirley, from Sunday, August 7th, 1949, over CBS originally, starring J. Carroll Nash, Alan Reed, Jody Gilbert, Mary Shipp, and Hans Conried. Bob Stevenson is announcing, and the show was sustained. Now, standing by with some challenging notes here about Life with Luigi is Stu.
Yeah, I kind of predict that the date with Shirley isn't going to go very well, but you'll find out.
Yeah.
Life with Luigi, conceived as The Little Immigrant, was announced by that title and changed just before the first broadcast. Its creator, Cy Howard, gave up a salesman job to become one of the big success stories of radio's dwindling days. By some accounts, Howard was a shy introvert when he decided to change his ways and turn his life around. He created My Friend Irma and soon, with Luigi, had two of radio's most popular shows. Luigi had the tougher schedule opposite Bob Hope, but within a year, the sitcom had pulled even with Hope and in some surveys even topped him. The show had a remarkable cast, so skilled in the uses of ethnic dialogue that the listeners completely bought the Italian scenario, though the title role was played by an Irishman. Luigi Basco was by nature a shy man with a sweet and loving disposition, consumed with the hope of someday becoming an American citizen. In his night school class, he met other newcomers from Germany and Scandinavia. The funniest of these was Schultz, whose rheumatism was always killing him. Soon after his arrival in Chicago, Luigi rented a building adjacent to Pasquale's Spaghetti Palace and opened his antique store. But it didn't take long for Luigi to settle into one long storyline, Pasquale's ruthless campaign to persuade, bribe, or coerce Luigi to marry his daughter Rosa. Luigi was awed by Rosa, her 300-pound frame, the squeaky voice, the giggles, and the stinging belly laugh were prime staples of the program. Pasquale was a lying, conniving plotter, a heartless saboteur of Luigi's love life, hence what I said about this episode. At the end, he always had Rosa on hand to help him pick up the pieces of Luigi's broken heart. Just so happen I'm a bring him a little baby with me. I'm a gonna call her over. Oh, Rosa, Rosa, Rosa! And Rosa would shriek, "You call me, Papa?" And Pasquale would purr, "Say hello to Luigi." And Rosa would erupt with the loudest fat girl laugh on all of radio, and ending with a squeaky, "Hello, Luigi." The situations were framed by the accordion playing "Oh, Marie" softly in the background. The premise was that each episode was a letter by Luigi to his Mama Basco in Italy. "Dear Mamma Mia," he would begin. At the end, the accordion came up for the closing theme. "So long, Mamma Mia. Your loving a son of Luigi Basco, the little immigrant." I always sound like Father Guido Sarducci when I try my Italian on for size. And you're hearing the Italian, yes, done by a Scotsman in this case.
Not clad in kilt.
Yes, and unless they buy me one, not going to be.
Did not leave a bar one evening fair.
Yeah. No, there's a bunch of friends of mine who say they all like to watch the Outlander series together. And they say, "Well, yeah, you can come watch with us, but only if you wear a kilt." And so I'm like, "Well, then I guess I won't be watching with you unless you buy me a kilt."
They just may.
Yeah.
They just may.
I'm not putting it past them. Yes, you know them all. You know they're liable to do that.
Of course, all of us are on a budget, so I don't know if we could actually afford it.
There is that. But, you know, strength in numbers. If they went in together, I could be in trouble.
Yeah, Kimba and Sherry would probably chip in and order one for you. I wouldn't be surprised if something gets delivered to your apartment sometime soon.
I
have never seen the series, so.
It's a good one.
All right.
I'll tell you about it while we're in the break.
Okay. Well, it's time for Life with Luigi. And don't forget, on the Mickey machine, switch off of the Armed Forces switch.
Right, right. And onto the Italian network. Yeah, yeah.
No, CBS. The Columbia Broadcasting System.
The CBS where you see the BS. Yeah.
Not then, it was radio. But, you know.
Yeah, well.
All right.
Okay.
You flip the switch?
Okay, yeah, I'm good. Flipping switches like a madman over here.
Nothing to be mad about.
Mad about you.
I've been helen hunting for that for a long time now.
Welcome to Bad Pun Theater.
Yes, I rise to the occasion. All right. Sit back, close your eyes, and remember, Life with Luigi. This is A Date with Shirley from Sunday, August 7th, 1949, originally over CBS.
Need to wash those puns off of me.
Hello, invite you to enjoy Life. Life with Luigi, a new comedy show created by Cy Howard and starring that celebrated actor, Mr. J. Carroll Nash, with Alan Reed as Pasquale. Basco left Italy to start his new life in America. He promised his mother that he would write and tell her about his adventures. So now let's read Luigi's letter as he writes to Mama Basco in Italy.
Dear Mamma Mia, remember how I'm right to you 2 weeks ago that I went to the beach with my class and a girl, Shirley? She was such a nice girl. I'ma remember, funny thing happened before I'ma took her out. I'ma call her up, and I'ma tell her I'm coming right over, and Shirley's a say, wait a half hour. I say, why so long? And she's a say, I gotta put on my face. I'ma say, your face? Where are you keeping it? She's a telling me, don't be silly, Luigi, I'm making up. It's a funny thing with this girl, Mamma Mia. I'ma never have a fight with her, and already she's a making up. Then I'ma find out this makeup is American expression. It's a mean things that a girl is put on to look beautiful. They got a dye for the hair, polish for the nails, rouge for the cheeks, powder for the face, and a lipstick for the lips. Mamma mia, I'ma think even if a little monkey is put on all this, he's a look beautiful too. Well, I'm thinking today how I'm like to go out with Shirley again. Ah, but what's the use to think? I'm not got the nerve to call her. Well, it's time for my night school class anyway, so I'm write to you later again. America, I love you. You like a papa to me. From ocean to ocean.
Quiet, please. Please. Now I'll call the roll. Mr. Basco?
Present.
Mr. Howard?
Present.
Mr. Olson?
Present.
Mr.
Stop! I give up.
Please, Mr. Schultz. Don't answer until I call your name.
Yeah.
Now, our lesson for today is geography, taking up the physical aspects of the Earth, including various climatic zones.
But when are you going to call my name?
Well, all right. Mr. Schultz?
No, I wouldn't answer. I'm temperamental.
Last, please. Mr. Schultz, what makes you so exuberant today?
Well, the government just sent me $40.
Oh, a tax refund?
Who knows? When they give, I take.
Last, please. Now, Mr. Horowitz,
yeah.
Our first geography question is, what do we call the imaginary belt that runs around the center of the Earth?
I don't know.
Mr. Basco?
I don't know.
Mr. Olson?
I don't know.
Mr. Shaw?
Don't ask me. I'm no squealer.
Mr. Schultz, you're not helping one bit. Now think, class. Think of a great big mass. Now, what name do we give to the thing that goes around the middle?
I know, Deja.
Well, good for you, Mr. Schultz. What is it?
A girdle.
No. It's the equator.
Believe me, the way the world is falling apart today, could use a girdle.
Now, class, I've just told you what it is. Now, the name of this imaginary line that goes around the Earth is called Mr. Basco?
Oh, is it called the Mr. Basco?
No, Mr. Basco. All during the class, you've been staring out the window. What have you been thinking of?
A girl.
Now, you pity him, and I bet you Luigi is in love with the teacher. Hoo-ha.
Hoo-ha, hoo-hoo. Luigi loves Miss Barney.
Luigi loves Miss Barney. Luigi loves Miss Barney.
Oh, class, please stop at this minute.
Miss Spalding, I'm sorry I'm making you nervous.
I am not nervous. Now, back to our lesson. The equator is a girdle and it's called Mr. Basco. I mean, Mr. Basco is bounded by...
Saved by the bell.
class dismissed. And Mr. Schultz, you may remain here with me.
No, I'm too old. Give Luigi a chance.
Go on. Good night.
No, good night.
Heaven, what a class. Well, let me look at myself. This new lipstick does do something for me.
Oh, Luigi, wait for me. Oh, listen to me. I'm breathing like an old accordion, but it's got one squeeze left in the box.
Hello, Schultz.
Hello, Luigi. I gotta apologize for the way I was acting in class.
I was acting a foolish myself, Schultz. And instead of thinking about the geography, my mind was on little birds flying around together. The squirrels all playing with each other, and the boys and the girls are holding their hands.
Oh, Luigi, you're silly.
Schultz, don't this nice summer weather mean nothing to you?
Sure, that's when I defrost my icebox. What's the matter with you today, Luigi? You're acting so silly.
Well, Schultz, remember 2 weeks ago how you got me a date with a girl, Shirley Smith?
Yeah.
I was thinking I would like to go out with her again, but I'm not got the nerve.
Ach, Luigi, don't be such a stupid cop. Just follow the American way. You go to the phone booth. You call her up. You say, Shirley, how's about going out tonight? She says, okay. You hang up. Then you stick your finger into the schlap and see if your nickel comes back.
Shirley, you think if I'm going to call her up, she's going to go?
Sure. This Saturday night, you're taking her to the movies.
But, Schultz, I'm going to never take a girl to the movies.
Luigi, that's the same thing like going by yourself, only when you go with a girl, you don't look at the pictures.
But if I'm going to look at the picture, Schultz, how am I going to enjoy myself?
Stop, Luigi. You're getting me all for shimmel. No, please stop being such a pessimist. Take the girl to the movie.
All right, Schultz. You give me courage. I'm going to call her up.
Good, good. And stop looking so worried. Be like me, Luigi. Be happy. Smile. My rheumatism is killing me.
Luigi, my friend. Hello, Luigi. Hello, hello.
Luigi, my friend, I like the way you say that. You know, Pasquale, is a nice day today, huh? I'm feeling good.
Hey, what are you so happy about? You fell down on your head, maybe? Somebody's dying to leave you $50?
You know, Pasquale, is better than that. This Saturday, I'm got a date with a girl.
Oh, Luigi, I'm so glad to hear that. You finally going to go out with my daughter Rosa, eh?
No, I'm going to go out with a girl.
What do you think of my daughter Rosa is? Don't answer that. Luigi, why you no go out with Rosa?
She's a too fat.
Fat to fat to fat. Every time we talk about a Rosa, that's all you can say.
That's all I can see.
You want to go out with a girl that's skinny like a toothpick? You go out with a Rosa, you got a nice armor full.
I'm going to go out there with a Rosa. I'm going to get a room full. No, it's no use, Pasquale. Saturday night, the Luigi's are going out to the movies.
You're going to take this girl to the movies? Ooh, that's a show how big a greenhorn you are.
What's wrong with that?
Everything. So you go to the movies, and what's happening? For 3 hours, you girls are looking at Clark Gable, you look at Ava Gardner. By the time you come out, you both hate each other. Luigi, don't you know it's against the law taking an American girl to movies on a first date?
No.
That's a violation of Emily's Post.
Emily's Post, what's that?
That's like the Saturday Evening Post, only Emily's Post is to take care of the rest of the week.
Mamma mia, is there so much to learn? Well, if I'm an oak, can I go to the movies? What else am I going to do with a girl?
First date, you got to take her dancing.
But, Pasquale, you know me. I'm not going to dance. In Italy, all I'm a dance is a tarantella.
Tarantella? Luigi, you way behind the times. They got a new dances in America now. There's, Charleston, then there's Black Bottom, that's a new twist 'em. And then there's another one that's just come out for fellas with a U-shaped head.
Oh. What the dance is this?
Square dance.
Pasquale, I'm no no does late the dances. If I'm go to a dance, I'm just to stand around doing nothing.
That's right. You what they call a wallpaper. wall of flower. Yeah. Luigi, my Rosa, she's just like you.
She's a wall of flower too?
Yes. So why two wallflowers and don't get married and have a little creeper, huh?
Stop. It's no use, Pasquale. The dancer for me is not possible. I think I'm going to take a chance. I'll call up with this girl and ask her if she's the one who got to the movie.
Go, call. You ain't called up yet, eh?
No.
Luigi, you ain't going to call this girl yourself, I'm hope.
Why not, the Pasquale?
Well, if you call yourself, a telephone company is a call that a person call, that's a cost you twice as much. Besides, the girl is liable to want to go to a dance, and then you're stuck.
Pasquale, what am I going to do?
What are you going to do? What do you always do? You holler help, comes Pasquale. Luigi, I'm going to call her up for you.
Pasquale, you think if you talk to her, she's got to movie with me instead of a dance?
Sure, I've got a lot of experience with American girls. I'm going to call up and say, hello, babe, how's about a painting the town of red with Luigi? He's good for that. He's got a head like a paintbrush. I'm going to make her laugh if she's going to do anything for you.
That's the sound of fine, Pasquale.
Sure, now give me her name and the telephone number. I'm going to call her.
Here, and thank you very much, Pasquale. You're a real friend.
Sure. Go, take a walk. Is there nothing I wouldn't do for you? Nothing. That's just what I'm going to do for him. Nothing. Ah, but a figure, hello? Is this the Shirley Smith? Mrs. Smith, my friend Luigi Basco is asking me to call you and tell you he's no care to take you to the movies. Well, you see, the picture's in a technicolor and he's a colorblind. Sure, if he's a go to see that picture, yellow sky, to him it's a come out of Red River. But don't worry, Shirley. Luigi's got a better idea than the movies. You like it to dance? That's fine. Luigi's crazy to dance, and he's like to meet you Saturday night in front of the Aragona Ballroom. You like, huh? Can he really dance? His whole family is a dancer, it's a show. Ever hear of Gina Kelly? That's Luigi's sister.
Life with Luigi continues in just a moment, but first, romance from two points of view, from a teenager's and from a pretty schoolmarm's. Romance with many a laugh fills a full hour just a little later on most of these CBS stations. First, you'll meet Corliss Archer, the teenager with the world's most vivid imagination and a genius at jumping to the wrong conclusion. Later, you'll have a date with our Miss Brooks, the schoolteacher who adds an R for romance to the other 3 R's of education. Eve Arden stars as our Miss Brooks, so be sure to meet Miss Brooks and Corliss Archer later tonight on CBS. And now for the second act of Luigi Basco's adventures in Chicago, we turn to page 2 of his letter to his mother in Italy.
And so, mamma mia, tonight is a finally come the big night. Pasquale is a tell me he's a fix everything up and I'm gonna take Shirley to the movies. Mamma mia, you should see how nice I'm dressed up. I'm looking a men's fashion magazine and a Tony's a shoeshine parlor. And it's to say that a men's clothes should always match. Well, I'm wearing a purple shirt and an orange tie. Also, socks are too much. One sock is a purple, the other is orange. Also, I'm one to smell good. But there was no aftershave and a lotion in the medicine chest. So I'm making my own lotion. I'm taking some cloves, some rubbing alcohol, some oil of wintergreen, glycerine, and rose water. Boil this and make it for 15 minutes. Then I'm going to pour the whole thing on myself. Mamma mia, I'm going to smell it just like a drugstore. Anyway, I'm standing and looking at myself in the mirror when in is a Kama Schultz.
Hello, Luigi. Ooh, you're looking nice. What do I smell?
What's the matter, Schultz?
Luigi, was you burning rubber tires in here? Open up the windows, let some fresh air in. Ooh, that's better. Well, Luigi, I was just talking to Shirley's mama, and she tells me the girl is all excited about going dancing with you tonight.
Yeah, I'm all excited. Huh? A dance singer? But if Pasquale is a call of Shirley and I tell her I'm taking her to the movies.
Pasquale? Oh, Luigi, you are such a dumb cop. Don't you know Pasquale is out to mix you up with any other girl?
But why?
Why, he asks, Rosa. Why should Pasquale help you with a molehill when he can't get rid of his mountain?
Schultz is a look-alike and my big day is a fall apart. I'm a no kind of dance.
Ah, Luigi, smile. Don't be afraid. There's nothing to dancing. It's the same thing like wrestling, only it's not fixed. No, come here, close to me. Come here, I'm going to show you how.
Yeah. All right, sure.
Now, first you take the girl. You hold her close to you like this.
Oh, sure, please. You squeeze it too hard.
But that's how you hold the girl.
So tight?
Sure, what do you think there is to dancing? Just dancing?
Schultz, you're just wasting your time with me.
No, wait, Luigi. I just got an idea. Why don't you take a professional dancing lesson?
Huh?
Sure, they learn you quick. Why don't you go dance with Arthur Murray?
Arthur Murray? No, thanks. I'm no dancer with a man.
What am I going to do with you, Luigi? Arthur Murray is a dancing school. Here, let me look in the paper. Yeah, I'm going to find it here. Yeah, I got it. You see? Murray's dance studio. With the magic step, you can learn to dance in one lesson.
Sure, so you think they teach you me?
Oh, sure, listen to this. With our beautiful young teachers holding you in their arms, gliding you across the floor, you can learn. Luigi, I just got another idea.
What, Schultz?
You stay here, I'll go.
No, Schultz, you convince me. I'm going to go to the dance studio right now.
Well, Mr. Baskels, that's a simple 1-2-3 step. So much for theory. Now, shall we put it into practice?
Yeah, but...
Fine, now you put your arm around me. Put your arm around me.
Please, maybe you got some more theory?
Mr. Basco, if you expect to do any dancing tonight, you better start now.
Well, all right.
Put your arm around me.
Like this?
No, not both arms, just one.
Which one?
The right one. Put it around me. Well, what are you waiting for?
I'm wondering where I should have put it.
Right here. Now, take my other hand and come closer.
Like this?
Closer.
Huh?
Closer.
Mamma mia, if I'm going to come any closer, I'm going to be behind you.
Now, I'll turn on the music. Now, Mr. Basco, do as I taught you. Lead me.
Mr. Burton, I'm not going to move.
Don't you remember what I told you?
I'm a remember, but I don't think my feet was a listener.
It's just beginner's fright. Just move your legs. There. That's it. Fine.
Hey, look at me. I'm a dancer. And I'm with my own feet.
Now, remember... While we're dancing, keep counting. 1, 2, 3.
I'm gonna remember.
Mr. Basco, are you counting?
Yep, I'm up to 96.
No. Just repeat the step. 1, 2, 3. Why are you letting go of my hand?
I got a signal for a turn.
We're not driving a car. Now hold on to me. And turn around. That's the way. Now we dip. Back, back, back.
I guess I'm a dipper too far back. Mr. Burton, it's no use. I'm never going to learn to dance in the time of tonight.
Oh, nonsense, Mr. Basco. Your girl will be surprised at how well you dance. Now, let's just try.
Luigi, thanks for taking me to this dance. You're a real nice fellow.
I think you're nicer too, Shirley. By and by, I buy you ice cream a cone.
Oh, da-do-da-do. Oh, gee, if there's anything I like of dancing.
Then why are we just standing here watching? Before was a waltz, you know, wanna dance. Now is a foxtrot. Do you still know dancing?
Oh, I'm waiting for my kind of music. Oh.
That's the music! Mamma mia, somebody must have been baked in a musician!
Let's dance, Luigi! Come on! Let me dance!
Skin, where am I gonna get it from?
Oh, don't be a square! Listen to that jive!
Jive?
Hurry! Let's get a rug!
Please, there's no damage to the furniture!
What are we waiting for? Let's go, Jackson!
Jackson? My name is Luigi! What's happened to this girl? She's a forget the my name.
Oh, the dance will be over soon. Aren't you gonna send me?
Send you? I'm gonna got the place to go.
Oh, I can't wait. Come on!
Hey, Donna,
oh,
pull!
Excuse
me, lady. I'm a... excuse me, mister. Excuse me.
Hey, why don't you look out?
Excuse me. I'm sorry. Excuse me.
Oh, shut up.
Shelley, please.
Oh, Luigi, I'm gone.
You're gone. I'm already went.
Come on, Luigi. Shake it.
Shake the what?
Don't just stand there. Look at everybody else. Throw me in the air.
Who's gonna catch you when you come down?
Oh, where? Viva,
viva, viva, viva! Mamma mia, this is America!
Woo-hoo! Oh.
Shirley, is the dance over?
That's right, Luigi.
Then please get off of my shoulder.
Boy, Luigi, what a deadbeat you turned out to be.
Excuse me, Shirley. I'm going to go to wash up a little. I'm going to be right back. Mamma mia, it's a summer place. I'm going to come here in a streetcar. I think I'm going to go home in an ambulance.
Luigi, my friend.
Hello, Pasquale. Hey, Pasquale, what are you doing in this dancer hall?
Just passing by. What's the matter with you? Hair's all over your face, the ties are gone, the clothes all mussed up. What's happened? Just have a fight with a vacuum cleaner?
No, Pasquale, I was a dancer. With a girl. And what a girl. She's a jump around like Uncle Pietro's a goat after he's a back into a barbed wire fence.
Oh.
And how she's a holler. Beat me with a rug, send me, tear off some skin of Jackson.
Luigi, you was a dancer with a jitterbug. This place is full of jitterbugs.
If I'm not that, I'm a come here with DDT. Pasquale, it's all your fault. You told Shirley I'm a take her to a dancer.
Luigi, I didn't know it was going to turn out like this. I was only trying to help you.
Hey, Pasquale. You want to help me? Then you dance with a Shirley and I'm going to go home.
I got a better idea, Luigi. How's it going to be if some other girl is to go over to Shirley and say, pardon me, miss, you dancing with my steady boyfriend and my finance. So how's about you leave him a go before I change the direction of your nose?
Pasquale, where am I going to get a girl who's to do that for me?
You lucky pupsy, you. I'm got just the girl. She's also just happened to be passing by. I'm going to call her. Rosa! Rosa! Rosa!
You called me, Papa!
Yes, my little Pavlova. Say hello to Luigi.
Hello, Luigi.
Hello, Rosa.
Rosa, Luigi wants you should do him a little favor. You go over to Luigi's girl and you say...
Hey, Pasquale, Shirley is gone. There she is. She's a walk away with another fella. Now I'm going to go home and get into a pail of hot water and soak my feet.
Wait, Luigi, why are you running? You have a bad time. You should have a little fun. Why you no relax? Rose is such a wonderful and nice dancer.
She is?
Sure. Roses are so good, they name a big dancer hall after her in New York. It's called a Rosaland. She's a dancer, waltz, a foxtrot.
Well, maybe I try.
Sure. Go ahead, Luigi. Dance with a Rosa. Enjoy.
Luigi! Jive music!
What the?
Meet me, Daddy, with the fly fly!
Mamma mia!
So, Mamma Mia, even though it's a nice summer day and I should be walking in a park with the birds, for me it's a turn out the other way. I'm laying here in a bed with bandages. Don't worry, I'm not to have such a big accident. It's just that while I was dancing, a Rosa is a fall on me. Doctor says no bones are broken. It's just that I'm a suffer from a shock. Anyway, while I'm laying here, I'm thinking things over. And you know something, Mamma Mia? I think I'm like this jiver who would re-bop and be-hop and shut up. I think I'm going to try dancing again. Yes, Mamma Mia, every day, in every way, I'm getting to be more like an American. Your loving son, Luigi Bosco, the little immigrant.
Life with Luigi is a Cy Howard production and is written by Mac Bunoff and Lou Derman and directed by Mac Benoff. J. Carroll Nash is starred as Luigi Basco with Alan Reed as Pasquale, Hans Conried as Schultz, Mary Shipp as Miss Spaulding, and Jody Gilbert as Rosa. Music is under the direction of Lynn Murray. Bob Stevenson speaking. For more laughter, for thorough enjoyment, join the college crowd in Young Love on most of these same CBS stations tomorrow night. Young Love is the story of two college students, happily married, who have to keep their wedded bliss a secret because of a faculty rule against student marriages. U.S. savings bonds are safe, profitable, and easy to buy. Later on, they'll come in very handy when you'll need money for your children's education, improvements on your house and property, or just for having that nest egg for a rainy day. Buy U.S. bonds regularly. And now stay tuned for the latest teenage adventure of Corliss Archer, which follows immediately over most of these same CBS stations. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Howdy, folks. This is Will Sugarfoot Hutchins. You are now listening to The Glowing Dial with your host, Big John, and Steve.
All right, we're back with you, folks. Hope you enjoyed Life with Luigi. That was A Date with Shirley from Sunday, August 7th, 1949, originally over CBS. We've got two more shows that aired on Stu's birthday to bring you.
Yeah.
And we're going to get started with the next one right after this important message.
Hi, Big John here to tell you all about the Glowing Dial online store. The Glowing Dial online store is your one-stop shop for all things Glowing Dial. You're sure to be fashionable with a t-shirt or sweatshirt emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo. And your favorite beverage will taste even better in an official Glowing Dial mug or stein. How about a Glowing Dial tote bag so you can carry around your OTR with style and grace? Or be the first on your block to own Volume 1 of the Glowing Dial Celebrity Interviews on audio CD. You can surf the internet with class with an official Glowing Dial mouse pad. And if that weren't enough, we'll be adding more items with new logo designs in the near future. Remember, every time you purchase an item from our online store, you're helping to support us here at the Glowing Dial. You know, you don't even have to leave your home and trudge into your overcrowded, noisy mall. You can just sit comfortably in front of your computer and do all your shopping online. All you have to do is to point your browser to glowingdial.com, click on the Glowing Dial online store link. Then, through the wonders of internet technology, you would be instantly whisked to our store's main page. There, you'll see all the items we have to offer. You're sure to find something to suit your fancy. And remember, our official Glowing Dial items make great gifts, too. And the ordering process is simple and safe using CafePress.com's secure server. Most orders are shipped within 2 business days. You can even check on the status of an existing order. So head on over to the Glowing Dial online store, the only place you can get official Glowing Dial merchandise. So what are you waiting for?
And we're back with you, and it's time for an episode of Night Watch. This is called Three-Time Loser and Shotgun Boy from Saturday, August 7th, 1954, over CBS. And it features Culver City, California patrolman. Don Reed is the police recorder. And also features Chief W.N. Hildebrand of the LAPD and is sustained. And this is kind of reality programming.
Yes.
Which is so popular now.
Kind of a prescient precursor to reality TV
kind
today.
Kind of cops on the radio.
And, exactly.
With some more information on Night Watches, too.
Well, bad boys, what you going to do?
When they come for you.
Yeah. Night Watch was the inevitable result of Dragnet's success, an attempt to bring the crime documentary to its peak by having a microphone present as the crime was being committed. Reporter Don Reed rode with the police during the 6 p.m. to 2 a.m. shift wearing a hidden wire to capture the high drama of the job. Before the premiere broadcast, Reed had accumulated about 100 reels of tape. Criminals caught in the act, including a homicide confession and the statement of a dope fiend. Reefer madness. There were no actors, no sound effects, no dramatic musical bridges. Everything was authentic, just as it happened. In one case, Reed was nearly shot, and in another, he was stabbed but was saved by a leather jacket. The show was produced in cooperation with Chief W.N. Hildebrand, and William Frug supervised for CBS. Vernon McKinney was the engineer, and Ray Gerhard was the editor, removing all traces of real names and locales. To protect the innocent. Night Watch ran from April 5th, 1954 to April 21st, 1955, 2 years before I was born, on CBS. And there you have it.
All right. Thank you, sir. And we were going to do a tribute. I wanted to do a tribute to reality programming on radio.
Ooh.
But there weren't that many examples. There's this Night Watch, which we're about to present to you, and Candid Microphone.
Oh.
Which was the Alan Funt's predecessor to Candid Camera.
Yeah. Well, there's the fake reality one in You Are There.
Right.
Wasn't really real, but, you know, they tried to make it like it would have been.
They used the War of the Worlds routine.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
Basically trying to make it like a real news team was back in time covering those events.
Exactly.
And you've heard that program before here on the Glowing Dial.
Probably will again.
Oh, yes. Just we can only present 4 shows at a time to you, so. And right now, it's going to be in that episode of Night Watch, so let's extract this episode from the ether of yesterday.
Yes, from August 7th.
Yeah. I see you've done your bit. Okay, good. We got it off Armed Forces and on to regular.
The Pizza Network.
Yeah, the Pizza Network. All right. Sit back, close your eyes, and remember, folks, this is Night Watch. Three-time loser and shotgun boy from Saturday, August 7th, 1954, originally over CBS.
Manja, manja, what's a coming to go?
Reporting in service, starting mileage 28,379. 28,379, on station call to meet unit 5-3 at Overland and Braddock.
Control 1-5-6-10-4, on station call, 6:14 p.m., starting night watch.
This is Don Reed, a police recorder. At the moment, you're in the back of Detective Unit 5-6, just reporting in service on the night watch. That was Sergeant Ron Perkins radioing Control 1. In just a couple of minutes, we're going to meet car 5-3 and pick up a detective from the forgery detail. But first, I want to remind you, these people are not actors. This is it. This is real. This is what happens on the Night Watch.
Night Watch, the actual on-the-scene report of your police force in action. There are no actors. There is no script. Every voice, every sound is authentic. The investigations are recorded as they actually occur. Night Watch, presented with the cooperation of the Police Department of Culver City, California. W.N. Hildebrand, Chief. And now we switch you to car 5-6, already on investigation somewhere in the field, and to police recorder Don Reed.
It's 6:48 p.m., and at the moment, we're en route to a Bay City to attempt to pick up a hot check suspect. Briefly, this is the picture. A few moments ago, we picked up Detective Hansen, forgery detail. He has definite information that a suspect wanted for cashing bad checks is now in a bar in Santa Monica. Just at this moment, we're going over a hill. Below us, the lights of this Bay City. And beyond, the Pacific Ocean with hundreds of little sailboats out there in the harbor, just barely visible in the semi-darkness. Hanson's going to use the radio now.
Go ahead. Will you call West L.A. and tell them to have Sergeant Barr meet me in the parking lot behind the Georgian Hotel on Ocean Street in Santa Monica? He's expecting the call.
Well, how come Barr can identify this guy? Was he in the market at the time?
On Friday and Saturday night, Barr works there extra watching the check cashing stand. And when this fellow tried to cash the check, they recognized the name because it said Stuckem on a whole bunch of checks before he was picked up the last time. And as soon as they made him, he run out of the store. Barr right after him. He went over that concrete wall fence in the back a little faster than Barr did and got away. So I told him I was meeting tonight, and if we made the meet, he would be down for me to give him a call and he'd come down and see if he could identify him.
I see.
See if it was the guy.
Well, that's the deal. If the suspect is in the bar, we'll hold him and see if the other officer can identify him. We're swinging into the hotel parking lot.
You want to go through the back door, Hanson, and I'll go into the front way.
We'll take up station here behind a couple of palm trees. There's a clear view straight through to the bar. I can see right through the front door. About 8 or 10 people are sitting on the stools there. One note I forgot to add. This suspect is a 3-time loser on the same charge. His record shows 3 arrests and 3 prison terms. In fact, I understand he just got out of jail, or joint, as some of the prisoners call it. Of course, as you heard, his big mistake, he left the market in such a hurry he forgot his driver's license. Now, Sergeant Perkins is coming through the front door and is meeting Detective Hansen. They're talking with someone at the bar. It's too dark to identify. The three are coming this way. Well, yeah, that's our boy, all right. I recognize him from the mug photo. Let's get a good look at the suspect under the lights. Tall, thin, sallow complexion. Well, we're all getting in the car now. The L.A. officer will be along in just a moment. And see if he can identify the suspect. Meanwhile, let's see what he has to say.
I've been in trouble with my record. What the heck's going to happen?
Well, how about the checks?
I blew my top one night and made a mistake.
And how about your old operator's license? Where is it?
That I don't know.
Now, don't give me any baloney.
I'm not. I'm giving it to you straight. I don't know.
Were you in Thrift Mart and tried to cash that check?
No, sir. No, sir. Absolutely not.
You tried to cash a check there where you'd cashed some before. They recognized the name and chased you out. And Sergeant Barr of West L.A. chased you, and you got away from him when you jumped over the brick fence in the back.
That wasn't me.
You're sure?
I'm positive.
What if he saw you?
Well, I wouldn't know whether he saw me or not. I mean, I don't know. I don't even know who you're talking about, so... That I didn't have anything to do with.
Well, where did you lose your operator's license?
Well, I don't know. I think I lost it when I first came back.
After you came back from the joint?
Yeah. I don't know. Just one day I happened to look for my license and I didn't have it. I mean...
How long have you been out of the joint?
December.
How much time did you spend up there?
A year. I might look like the guy or something. I don't know. I mean, that's part I wouldn't know, but it's... Mm-hmm. I sure as heck I'm not the guy.
Is this the only check you have out?
The one I was telling you about.
There's none other anywhere else?
No.
What's going to happen the next time you get drunk?
I'm not going to get drunk. I'm working now and I...
How'd you find out that you'd written the check if you were drunk that night?
I didn't even know I'd written it.
You're Sergeant Barr now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What's going on?
Pulling in beside our car, the officer who possibly can identify the suspect. Let's get out of the car. Sergeant's coming over. Studying the suspect.
I would say yes. I have a copy of his operator's license.
You have?
I can check his thumbprint against the one on his operator's license.
Well, he doesn't deny the operator's license. That's where he lived on paper, but he says that just after he got out of the joint that he lost his operator's license.
What, an operator's license or a chauffeur's license?
Chauffeur's license.
Well, you lost your chauffeur's license to me. You're lucky you didn't get a little lid.
I don't think so.
No, I think so. You recall down at Thrift Mart when you passed the check? I mean, we're not kidding each other. It's just a matter of fact. And to me, you appear to be the one. And when I check the operator's license against the thumbprint, well, I'd be satisfied. Other witnesses can identify you. And it fell up on top of the roof, threw a brick at you, but he missed you when you went over the fence. In fact, you have another check out that you passed at the same market prior to this time. That you didn't pick up. Do you recall that?
Oh, yeah. I recall that if you're talking about the market up there on Venice Boulevard,
yeah, so why did you run that day?
Well, as far as the checks are concerned at that market, yes, you are very correct. I have passed a check there. Oh. And for that, I did time for it.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir, you're so right.
How about
there.
The one that you passed there the day you ran? There's no use of denying it. It's a matter of fact now. I mean, we're not trying to put anything on you that doesn't belong on you, but they still have the check. They still have your chauffeur's license. And what you lost, that is true, but you lost it at the market that day, not after you get out of the joint. Got a matter of that, right? It's just a matter of getting witnesses to prove it, that's all, which are available. A little hard up for dough, is that it?
Well... The suspect, as you heard, denies all knowledge of the crime, so he's being placed in the back seat of our car, and the officers are walking over here for a little private conference. Let's go on over to the car now and see if he tells the same story when the officers are not around. You
You don't think you fool that officer by any chance, do you?
See, if I haven't been in no trouble in my life, I'd have said, yeah. I'm a loser. So what am I going to do? Stand up there and say, I'm the guy? I got to fight it out all the way.
Mm. Well, I knew this sergeant had you made the minute he came up.
Yeah, on that spotted right now. I had the same coat on. Of all times, I happen to have this on tonight. I haven't worn this in 3 weeks, and I happen to have it on tonight. Same coat.
Well, that's why he didn't have any trouble spotting you.
Sure.
The minute he walked up.
I knew he was going to make me. I knew that.
You get up pretty early to fool him, I'll be honest with you.
Well, I wasn't trying to fool anybody. Well, I was. Too, I mean, in a way, yes, I was trying to fool somebody. But when I walked up here tonight, I figured that I was going.
Sergeant made you.
Yeah, well, I figured then I was going for sure. I didn't think it was any chance then. Any chance at all to get out.
How'd you happen to go into that place to try to pass that hot check?
I remember now. See, I mean, I didn't even say anything. He hollered to stop or I'll shoot. You know, he said, I'd shoot. But at the time, I mean, it wouldn't have mattered to me because I knew what it meant to me. If the man turns me back, I know where I'm going. 1 to 14 years, and I'm not about to do no 1 to 14 years.
Okay. You're a two-time loser?
Three.
Three-time loser?
Three-time loser.
That's it, boy. You've had it.
That's right. I've had it. Exactly.
Okay, pal. I'm going over and talk with the officers. Perk, see you a minute.
Yeah, what's up?
I was talking to the suspect off the record. He admits passing the bad checks and the escape.
Yeah? All we got to do is have him admit it to us now.
You'll hear him. I recorded the whole thing on tape.
You are listening to Night Watch and following the activities of a detective unit on its tour of duty. The people and sounds you hear are real, and the investigations are recorded in the field as they actually occur. We'll bring you the final results of tonight's action at the conclusion of Night Watch. And now we switch you back to car 5-6 on patrol and to police recorder Don Reed.
We've been back on patrol for better than an hour. But a few moments ago, we received a call from car 5-2. They were holding a suspect and requested that we meet them. That's all the information we have. But we'll find out more about it in just a moment because right ahead, the flashing lights of a police unit. Officer Cameron has a young fellow in custody. His partner, Paul Good, coming over. Let's go over and see what this is all about. What do you got, Paul?
Well, we were partner and I were cruising along and we saw this kid walking down the street and had a pretty strange looking package under his arm. So we turned around and shook him down and found out the kid's packing a 16-gauge shotgun. Got about 3 boxes of ammo with him, a cartridge belt full. Just wandering aimlessly around this time of night.
The boy, huh?
Yeah.
I've seen him before. We booked him on burglary. In fact, the other night, I stopped him for shooting BB guns at a car.
Right.
Looking over at the young fellow, he appears to be about 15 or 16, wearing Levi's with a GI cartridge belt wrapped around his middle. Sergeant Perkins is talking with the boy, so let's move right on over there.
Thanks, boys. Well, I don't give a call this minute. You got a receipt for it?
No.
How much you pay for it?
Without the tax, it was $22.55.
And they sold it to you?
Yeah. Walk in, since I want to buy a shotgun. Those are shells. He says, I want to buy a shotgun. He sold me those, too.
Anybody's been arrested on a felony is not permitted to have a gun.
You're not going to get the guy in trouble, are you?
Yes, we are. If he sells a minor a gun, we certainly are. Take him up there.
Well, the young fellow is being placed in the back seat of car 5-2.
We're going to go on to the station. Take him in, too.
Here at the office of the Detective Bureau. The young boy picked up with a shotgun is just coming into the room, sitting across the desk from Sergeant Perkins.
Not too worried about this problem, apparently, despite the fact among his previous arrests is burglary, a felony, which makes this charge of having a gun in his possession a very serious one.
About how long ago would that be?
Oh, a couple weeks before we moved.
Your folks don't know that you have it?
Mm-mm.
What are they going to say?
I don't know what my dad's going to say. My mother won't say much.
Where were you going tonight with it?
I was taking it out of the bus stop. I was going to hide it in the weeds, see? And then in the morning, when I go down to the bus stop, pick it up and take it on the bus, because I couldn't take the chance of taking it out of the house with me. I mean, taking it out of the garage, taking it down the alley there and out.
Where were you going to take the gun?
Redondo Beach.
Why?
See, that's where a friend of mine lives. We go hunting up there. And way up in behind there, there's real nice hills for hunting. Hawks, not many rabbits, rattlesnakes, and...
Do you, you know how to handle that gun?
Mm-hmm.
You ever fired it?
Nope.
You ever fired a shotgun?
Yeah, I used a 12 and I've used a 16.
Do you know it's against the law for you to have one in your possession?
I had a faint idea about it, but I wasn't sure whether it was against the law for... I knew it was against the law for me to have it because my parents don't know I've got it. And I bought it... I don't know whether you'd consider it buying it illegal. I told the guy, my parents said it was okay, so he sold it to me.
When were you arrested for burglary? What was the date? In February this year?
You mean...
The first time.
The tools, the deals?
Yeah.
I don't know.
The first part of this year, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's why, I see, when everybody picked me up and they asked me, why did you swipe the tools? I said, I didn't know. Well, it was for the money to get the gun. And you see, I was starting collecting right then. And a couple times since, my mother's found little bits of money. I told her I was saving up for other things, but I was saving it for the gun. And seeing I was going to sell those tools for $10, and I already had 15, and that's all I needed to buy the gun. But then you caught me on that deal, so I didn't get the 10.
The other day when I talked to you, I told you about those BB guns. And within 2 days after that, you're out firing BB guns again. Seems to me you don't learn.
I wasn't going to hurt anything with a gun.
You don't consider hurting anything or anybody by stealing the money to buy the gun.
But I didn't steal the money to buy the gun. I was going to steal the money, but you caught me for it, so then I had to save it out of my other money.
Well, looks like you're going to spend a little time with us tonight.
Why?
For having that shotgun. Apparently, somebody doesn't have proper control over you. You hear I'm one burglary.
I didn't steal the gun.
I'm not talking about stealing the gun. It's possession that's illegal. Anyone under the age of 18. You knew it was wrong. Otherwise, you'd have told your parents about it. You knew your parents wouldn't approve of your having that gun.
They don't trust me with a gun.
I don't either. That's why you're here. Take him on upstairs. Put him in the cell.
The boy is being escorted from the office. He will be held here temporarily, at least until the investigation is completed. About 45 minutes have passed since we talked to the young boy. Meanwhile, the sergeant put in a call for the owner of the store where the gun was purchased. He has just entered the office. Nervous. Not quite sure what it's all about.
I wanted to get some information. Do you sell any firearms down there at your store?
Well, we sell 22s once in a while, and we take orders on. We don't actually
any
stock.
Any shotguns down there?
Don't we don't stock them at all.
Do you sell any? Have you sold any in the last couple months down there?
I think we sold one.
Who was that to? Do you remember?
Some young fella.
How old was he?
About 16, I guess.
About shotgun shells.
Yes, we sold the same fella shells.
Are you the owner of the store there?
Yeah.
Are you familiar with the ordinance that prohibits the sale of firearms to minors?
Actually, I'm not familiar one way or the other with it,
Have you been informed relative to selling of
Firearms?
No.
Radio car officers, Officer Cameron and Officer Good, picked up a 16-year-old boy tonight carrying a shotgun and all these shotgun shells. He purchased the shotgun from your store. Now, as far as we're concerned, it's a very serious thing.
This kid has been... I honestly don't know when he started to buy them, but he'd been coming in and buying shells. Now, whether he came in once with his father or not, I don't know. He had been looking at this gun for months and months and said his father finally gave him permission to get it. And he brought in fact, it took us maybe 3-4 weeks to get the gun for him. And that's how we sold it to him. I actually thought that he had his father's consent.
His parents know nothing about the gun whatsoever.
See, he said his parents gave him the money.
But he is a juvenile, and it's your responsibility to...
I realize that now. Believe me, I guess I have to take the full responsibility for it. I realize the seriousness. Really, I do.
Well, it's more serious than I think than you realize, because this boy is not the type of boy that should have a gun. Somebody might have gotten hurt. And if somebody had gotten hurt, you would be criminally responsible, the same as the boy and his parents. Now, we have no alternative in this particular case but to request that the city attorney file a complaint against you.
I would
suggest that in the future that you refrain from selling any type of a deadly weapon.
Well, I definitely will. I'm just sick, that's all. I've never done anything wrong. I've always tried to do the right thing. That's all. Thank God nobody was hurt. I'm not trying to ease myself. I'm just sick, that's all, really.
The fact the officer spotted him before somebody got hurt with a gun.
I'm just sick about it. I'll go outside. My wife will give me worse than what you did so far. But I really am very sick about this thing. And anything that I can do, I will do.
Okay, sir.
I've always been cooperative, and I certainly... I
didn't
want to do anything that was...
I'll drop down first part of the week and discuss it with you. I'm sure we'll work out.
Okay, thanks for coming in.
Well, most of the investigation is over on this case. We're on the last lap. That is, we're about to notify the parents of this young fellow with a shotgun. Now, we're just pulling up in front of his house. Up the walk. It's a modest home here in the suburbs. A couple of bikes and some roller skates on the porch. Young, attractive woman coming to the door. The screen's open. Sergeant is advising her of the problem.
I'm driving off, Mr. Meyer. I got home from the show, and I thought it was at a kid's house, and I'm just sick.
Can we
come in now? Oh, come on in. What happened now?
Well,
we're moving furniture
that's
here.
That's right. He was carrying a shotgun down here earlier this evening.
A shotgun?
A shotgun.
You mean a real shotgun?
Real shotgun. A bunch of shotgun shells. He bought the gun about a month and a half ago from this store over here.
Uh-huh.
They sold it to him. We talked to the manager. He's admitted it, and we're filing action against him for selling to a minor.
Oh, I've been so mad at them. They've sold shells, and he's given them to other kids, and they'll sell anything to any kid. No matter who it is, they'll sell anything if they have the money.
Well, we're putting a stop to it because we're filing action against them on that basis.
Well, we had everything settled yesterday. We talked it all over, and we're going to take him to a doctor and have treatment, and... I can hardly talk. I got so upset when I got home. We decided that everything would be okay and we would let him have psychiatric treatment, mm-hmm. which we thought would straighten him out and all that. He shouldn't be out at night, and I haven't let him be. So tonight we wanted to go to the drive-in, and we asked him to go, and he didn't want to go to the drive-in. I got home and he wasn't home.
Well, we were trying to get hold of his first chance we had to get back
down
here.
Well, have you done anything, though? I mean, can
he
come
home? No, yes, we can be released
to
you.
Oh, I'm telling you.
But the thing, the fact that the trouble he's been in and the fact that he was carrying this gun, he
could have
gotten into trouble.
Uh-huh.
somebody could have gotten hurt. That's a pretty deadly weapon, that shotgun. Well, if you want to, can you go to get your car?
Yes.
You want to go on down and I'll notify them to release.
Do I have to go in there again?
No.
Oh, God.
Check him out.
Okay, let's go.
Well, the problem seems fairly well squared away. The boy will be released to his mother.
I'll be right back, honey. Well, get your PJs on, honey.
Right, I'll call him and tell him to let him go.
Good night. Let's get back to our radio car.
Five, six to one.
Throw one to 5-6, go ahead.
5-6, on our present call in regards to the possession of a shotgun, will you release the juvenile to his mother? She'll be at the station in about 5 minutes. I'll sign the necessary papers when I 10-19.
Control 15-6-10-4, will do.
You know, Perk, I had a mania for guns when I was a kid, too. You know, maybe this whole thing could have been avoided if he had a dad like mine. He used to take me hunting.
Could be.
What you have just heard is real. Recorded as it actually happened. And now, back to police headquarters and Chief W.N. Hildebrand.
Tonight's first investigation involving the suspect passing bad checks, the case took an unusual twist inasmuch as the suspect denied any knowledge of the crime when first questioned by the officers. However, after listening to his recorded admission, he confessed he was the man who had attempted escape after passing the bad check. The final investigation of the boy illegally possessing a shotgun showed where we must have the cooperation of store owners where firearms are sold. Many tragedies will be avoided in the future if tonight's case is well remembered. No police department can cooperate efficiently without the eyes and ears of the American public. To further that cause is the reason we bring you Night Watch.
Thank you, Chief Hildebrand. You have been following the on-the-scene reports of your police force in action. Every voice, every sound has been real. Night Watch, brought to you through the cooperation of the Police Department of Culver City, California, is produced by Sterling Tracy and Jim Headlock, with technical advice by Sergeant Ron Perkins, and described in the field by the official police recorder, Don Reed.
Hi there, this is Bill Bragg, the man with a million friends, and you're listening to The Glowing Dial with my good friends Big John and Steve.
And we're back with you, folks. You just heard Night Watch. It's called Three-Time Loser and Shotgun Boy. That was from Saturday, August 7th, 1954, originally over CBS. That was kind of the original Cops.
Yes.
Cops on the radio. So one of radio's earliest ventures into reality, which is so popular on TV and cable and satellite now.
Yep.
It's almost all that there is.
Although I do tell my friends that I believe Cops is the only actual reality show on television. And you can tell because even at the end of like Survivor or some of the other shows, you notice credits for writers. I'm sorry, yeah. Reality doesn't have writers. Thanks for playing.
Well, we have one more show to bring you, and also aired on Stu's birthday.
Yes.
We're going to get to that right after this message.
Hi, Big John here to tell you how you can help support The Glowing Dial. You know, it takes a lot of time and effort to maintain The Glowing Dial page and produce new episodes of the show. It also takes something we usually don't have enough of, money. The Glowing Dial page and show are nonprofit entities, and all costs incurred come out of our pockets, and we could use a little help from you, our listeners. There are several ways you can help support The Glowing Dial, and all of these methods can be accessed on our main page at www.glowingdial.com. One way to support us is to check on the PayPal donation box icon on our main page and make a donation. It can be as little or as much as you can afford. Every little bit helps. Another way is to purchase items from the Glowing Dial online store through CafePress.com. There you will find an ever-increasing variety of items emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo. You can also shop in the Glowing Dial bookstore through our association with Amazon.com. Every time you order something from our bookstore, you are helping to support the Glowing Dial. If you're a fan of Dick Organ's radio work, then why not order the complete set of Chicken Man episodes on CD? Just scroll down our main page until you see those silly dancing chickens. Purchase of this set also helps to support us here at the Glowing Dial. So there you have it, folks. Four ways that you can help support us and ensure the continuation of the Glowing Dial page and show. We thank you in advance. And we are back. It's time for our last episode that aired on Stu's birthday, although not the exact year. It's an episode of X-1. It's called The Last Martian, from Tuesday, August 7th, 1956, just 1 year before you came into being.
Closest one yet.
This is originally over NBC and starring Mandel Kramer, Elliot Reed, Santos Ortega, Ralph Bell, John McGovern, and Patricia Wheel. Fred Collins is announcing, and the show was sustained. And Stu is standing by to, or actually sitting by, to give us a good hefty deal of information on X-1.
Yeah, this is a good one. X-1 was an extension of the NBC science fiction series Dimension X. Its scheduling was erratic. This gave it little chance to break out of its hardcore genre following and perhaps attract a broader audience. This is debatable, but what is widely agreed on almost four decades later is that the most interesting dramatic radio of the 1955 season was produced by two genre series, Gunsmoke, a Western, and this space opera. Though X-1 did contain some old hat sci-fi moralizing, it blew through NBC like a breath of fresh air. The first 15 shows were straight repeats of Dimension X. Then X-1 struck out into deeper space with new adaptations from a leading sci-fi magazine and an occasional original to keep the mix intriguing. These were not stories for children, though they could certainly listen and be fascinated, but the stories didn't all end happily. Some of the most memorable episodes were those in which the aliens triumphed. Who could forget the closing scene of Ray Bradbury's Mars is Heaven, with the last Earthman frantically trying to radio home while the Martians break into the ship and overwhelm him? Dimension X had explored such ground, and X-1 transcended the parent program with some of the most creative melodrama the medium has yet heard. With its magazine affiliations, the two dozen shows from Astounding were followed by almost 90 shows from Galaxy, came a well of untapped talent. Stories by such young writers as Isaac Asimov, Robert Bloch, Robert A. Heinlein, Poul Anderson, and Theodore Sturgeon, who became the old lions to the generation that followed them. A major asset was the NBC writing staff. The two primary adapters, Ernest Kenoy and George Lefferts, were capable not only of distilling magazine stories, but of writing their own superb originals. Among the best episodes were these: The Cold Equation, a truly haunting tale of a young woman who playfully stows away on a spaceship only to learn that the fuel supply is critical and that her weight has pushed it to the point of disaster. Junkyard, a space expedition comes upon a dumping ground on an unoccupied world and then discovers that something is sucking out its collective intelligence and that there isn't even enough know-how left to run the ship. Tunnel Under the World, a Frederick Pohl story of a monstrous experiment concocted by the brain trust of an ad agency, Pure Radio with a knockout ending, A Pale of Air, Fritz Lieber's story of survival on a world gone cold and airless after being ripped away from its sun, and The Seventh Victim, a Robert Sheckley story of a future that curbs violence by allowing society's predators to legally hunt down and murder people, adapted probably most recently as The Purge. X-1 ran from April 21st, 1955 to January 9th, 1958 on NBC.
All right. Thank you so much. And yeah, you mentioned Tunnel Under the World.
Yes.
That was one of my favorites.
Yes. Didn't we hear that?
We've featured that on the Glowing Dial before. It's in the Glowing Dial archives. So take a look for it. We have a list of all our past shows on the Glowing Dial page. www.glowingdial.com.
There you go. Insert unabashed self-promotion here.
Yeah, we usually promote it at the end of the show, but, you know.
There you go.
We'll say it now, and we will also say at this point that we'd like to have your emails.
Yes.
You know, let's hear from you. We heard we did a South African radio tribute recently, and we got a nice email on that.
Oh, nice.
Somebody appreciated what we did.
So, in other words, you want the listeners' emails, not mine, because they're pretty boring.
Yeah. Well, okay. No, I can turn over here and just talk right to you.
There you go.
All right. Well, let's get this show rolling, shall we?
Yeah. Fire up the rockets. Oh, I mean, the McGee machine.
Off.
Yeah.
X minus 5, 4, 3, 2.
Fire 1.
X minus 1.
Fire 2.
All right, folks, sit back and enjoy X minus 1, The Last Martian, from Tuesday, August 7th, 1956, originally over NBC.
Satisfactory. Most satisfactory.
In just a moment, X minus 1, but first. Now there's a melody you'll recognize, opus number 1 in the inimitable Dorsey style. And there'll be lots more of your favorite tunes, old and new, on NBC Bandstand all this week. The Dorsey Brothers will appear in person, and you'll also enjoy some of the sweetest music this side of heaven by Guy Lombardo and the Royal Canadians. Wayne King and Freddie Martin come along, too, together with bright personalities like Burt Parks and Johnny Mercer. It's wonderful live music weekday mornings with NBC Bandstand.
Now stay tuned for X minus 1 on NBC.
Countdown for blast off. X minus 5, 4, 3, 2, X minus 1, fire.
From the far horizons of the unknown come transcribed tales of new dimensions in time and space. These are stories of the future. Adventures in which you'll live in a million could-be years on a thousand maybe worlds. The National Broadcasting Company, in cooperation with Galaxy Science Fiction Magazine, presents
X minus
one. Tonight, The Last Martian by Frederick Brown.
It was like any evening, but duller than most. I was back in the city room. I'd just covered a boring banquet, and the food had been so bad that I felt cheated, even though it cost me nothing. Now, just for laughs, and my job, I was writing a long, glowing account of it.
City desk, Cargan.
Yeah? You what?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sure, why not? Okay, Bonnie. Yeah. Bill.
Yeah?
You finished typing that banquet story yet?
Uh-uh.
Finish it, huh?
30. Okay.
You know Barney Welch, don't you?
Barney's bar? Of course I know him.
I know you know him. It's just a rhetorical question.
What about him?
He just phoned.
So?
He's got a guy down there.
Who?
Claims to be from Mars.
But is he drunk or raving or both?
Barney doesn't know. But he said there might be a gag story if you want to come over and talk to the guy.
Drinks on the expense account?
Here. You got a deal.
There wasn't a Trib reporter who didn't know Barney well enough to borrow money from him. I made for the bar like a St. Bernard makes for a fallen traveler and ordered a quick one with water on the side. Keep the bottle handy, Barney. Which one is the Martian?
You seen the tall, dismal-looking guy sitting alone there in the booth?
Over there?
That's him.
What's his story?
Well, he says he just got in from Mars 2 hours ago, and he's trying to figure it out. He claims he's the last living Martian.
Mm-hmm. Does he know I'm a reporter?
Huh. But he'd talk to anybody who'll listen to him.
What's his name?
He says it's Yangan Dao.
I'll talk to him.
Now, listen, Bill.
Yeah?
Don't get him violent or anything, huh? I don't want no trouble in my place.
Oh, now, don't worry, Barney. Look, dish up 2 beers for us, and I'll take him over with me. Barney drew 2 beers and cut off the heads. He rang up 60 cents, gave me my change, and I went over to the Martian. Mr. Dow?
Yes?
You mind if I sit down?
Help yourself. It's a free country.
I brought you beer. Barney, the bartender, told me something about your problem.
Oh? Thanks for the beer.
Drink up.
Well, I suppose you think I'm out of my mind, but... Well, maybe you'll be right. The bartender probably thinks I've flipped my lid. Listen, are you a doctor?
Nope.
Do you think I'm insane?
I'm not a doctor, and I haven't even heard your story yet. How can I tell?
Okay, I'll tell you. I'll tell you everything that happened. Then you tell me if you think I'm all right. 2 hours ago, I was on Mars.
2 hours? How did you get here?
I don't know. That's the horrible thing. All I know is that the others were dead.
All of them? How do you know?
I saw them. I saw their bodies in the street. It was awful.
Now, wait a minute. You mean you're the last one? The last Martian?
Yes.
Well, that's it's a little hard to believe.
Listen, I was there. I was in this room in the city of Scar. I don't know why I was there, but I was. I was locked in. Then I got hungry, and there was nobody to bring me food. So I worked a stone out of the floor and started digging. It took 3 days. When I got out and reached the street, everyone was dead, lying in the open.
What did you do?
I took a Targan, an energy plane, and flew it to Xandar. Xandar is the biggest city, the capital. Every place, it was the same. Hundreds of thousands of bodies. Lying in the fields, the streets, as if everyone had died at the exact same instant. At Xandar, in the stadium.
I'm listening.
In the stadium. There were 100,000 of them. As if they'd come there specially to die together. I landed my ship there.
In the stadium?
Yes.
I see.
Well, there... In the stadium, they had built some sort of platform. On it was a column made of copper. Copper is a rare metal on Mars. And there was a push button.
Where?
In the copper column.
Oh.
And there was a Martian in a blue robe, a priest, right under the button. It was as though he'd pushed the button and died. And everybody else had died with him.
Except you.
Yes. All except me.
And then?
And then... I was on a Madison Avenue bus, riding to work, here in New York.
Oh, now wait a minute.
Listen, I know you don't believe me. I know it sounds as if I was stark raving mad, but...
Take it easy, huh? You know what I think.
What?
You've had some sort of terrible shock.
Well, of course I have. There were 3 million of us. All dead.
I don't mean that kind of shock.
Of course, it was a dying world anyway. We didn't have more than 2 generations left. It was the krill.
What was the krill?
The disease. It reduced us to 1/30th of our population in 2 centuries.
These 3 million, and they died of the krill?
No. The krill kills slowly. These people died like that. The push of a button.
Why didn't they escape?
We tried to develop space travel, but we couldn't. We couldn't even reach Deimos or Phobos.
Where are they?
our moons.
Oh, I don't know too much about this stuff.
It was horrible.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask you a question, Mr. Down?
Anything you like.
Well, if the Martians didn't develop space travel, how do you think you got here in New York City?
I don't know. It's driving me wild. I'm Yangan Dal, a Martian. And I'm here, in the body of an Earthman.
The body of an Earthman?
Of course. You don't think Martians look exactly like humans, do you? I'm 3 feet tall, weigh what would be 20 pounds here on Earth. I have 4 arms and 6 fingers on each hand.
Barney?
Yeah?
2 more beers, huh, with whiskey chasers?
Right.
Go on, Mr. Dahl. I don't mean to interrupt.
It frightens me.
Oh, I can understand that.
Give you drinks. You want some help?
Uh-uh. Thanks, Barney. Drink up, Mr. Dahl.
Thank you.
By the way, who is this Earthman whose body you've got?
Its name is Howard Wilcox.
Howard Wilcox, hmm? I'll just write that down. Address?
It's in the wallet. 45 Amber Court.
Mm-hmm. This Howard Wilcox, whose body you're in, does he have a family?
It is married to a female of this species, yes.
Well, have you been home?
No.
Then how do you know?
I have all of its memories. I can do everything it could do. I know everything it knows.
Oh, I see.
I even have its tastes.
Beer, for instance?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You have a job?
At the Humber Lamp Company, 34th Street.
Well, maybe you ought to call your wife.
No, it frightens me.
Why?
This body, it loves its wife. Let me buy us a round. There's money in these pockets.
Okay.
It's very good of you to listen to my story. Barkeep, another round, please.
Tell me, Mr. Dahl, did you ever suspect before that you were a Martian?
Suspect? I am a Martian. Don't you understand?
Well, how did you get in here?
I told you I was... I mean, this body was on its way to work on a Madison Avenue bus, and then I was inside it. It was thirsty, so it stopped for a drink. And I thought maybe the bartender could give me some advice. So I started talking. Don't you believe me?
Listen, Howard, you should be due home for dinner by now. Now, you're making your wife worry. Why not phone her?
I'm afraid.
What's there to worry about? Whether you're Yangan Dal or Howard Wilcox is a woman sitting home worrying.
I suppose you're right.
Of course I'm right.
You're very understanding.
Oh, not at all.
You wouldn't want to come with me, would you?
Hmm?
I mean, I'm sort of afraid.
Well, it would look funny.
I could tell her you're an old school friend. We could have dinner. And then maybe I could get to know her.
You really want me to come?
Would you?
Let me make a phone call first, okay?
Fine.
I rang up the Tribune and got Cargan at the city desk. Hi, Bill Everett.
Did you find him?
Uh-huh.
Well?
There's something strange about this guy.
You think he's insane?
I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know? Is he or isn't he?
Well, he's got the whole story so perfectly organized, he might even convince somebody it's true. He remembers every detail.
What do you figure you're going to do?
Well, I'm going home with him. I'm going to meet his wife and observe them.
How many drinks have you had?
Oh, I'm sober. Don't worry.
Me worry? Look, maybe you better come back here and I'll let Vincent handle this stuff.
No, that isn't necessary. Just let me tag along a while.
Okay. But if you want help, yell and I'll send Vincent.
I will, don't worry.
What's this guy's name?
Howard Wilcox.
Address?
45 Amber Court.
Okay. Oh, and Bill?
Yes?
Just remember one thing.
What's that?
You could be playing with dynamite. Watch your step.
Number 45 Amber Court was an apartment down in the village. We were met at the door by a pretty woman in dungarees with her black hair and a ponytail with a red ribbon. Let me handle it, okay?
I wish you would.
How
Howard, I was so worried.
This is Bill Everett.
I'm an old boyhood chum of your husband, Mrs. Wilcox. We met and I asked Howard to have a few drinks and, I'm afraid it's all my fault.
Bill is having dinner with us.
If it isn't too much trouble.
Well, No, of course not.
Well, that's very generous of you.
Well, if you'll excuse me, I'd better start dinner. Howard?
Yes?
Are you all right?
Why, yes. Fine.
You didn't kiss me.
Oh, well.
That's better. That's the first time in 11 years Howard hasn't kissed me when he came home.
Well, we stopped and had a few drinks. It was all my fault, really.
Look, just make yourself comfortable. I won't be long.
Do you think she suspects?
Of course not.
I'll have to tell her.
You want to wind up in an institution?
No, but I can't keep up this pretense.
Just set your mind to it. Now, after a while, it'll become natural. You'll forget that you ever were a Martian.
You do believe me, then, about being a Martian?
Of course.
Oh, that's good to know.
Now, look, whatever you do, don't tell your wife. It would ruin her life.
I'll try not to tell her.
Try very hard. Now, don't tell anybody.
You and the bartender know, of course.
Well, we'll keep it quiet. Don't worry.
Good.
You think you can carry it off?
I'll try.
Good boy. Now, tell you what. If you get into any kind of trouble, I mean, if you just have to talk to somebody about it, give me a call, hmm? Here, at this number. Now, if I'm not in, you leave a message with my boss. His name is Cargan.
Cargan.
You promise?
I promise.
Fine.
You're very kind. This body... I mean, I've never met anybody so kind here on Earth.
Forget it.
Well, what have you two been discussing so secretly?
Just business.
Oh, I'm sorry about being late, dear.
Well, you might have phoned. After all, you were only a few blocks from the house. It isn't as if you were on Mars or someplace.
Dinner went pretty well, and Elaine Wilcox turned out to be an expert at shish kebab, which is one of my favorites. After dinner, I still had a couple of hours to put in at the paper, so I went back. Cargan came over to me right away. Well? Well?
Is he or isn't he?
He's a Martian, all right. No question about that.
You're very funny.
I have my moments.
Would you mind telling me exactly where you've been for 3 hours and what you've been doing?
I talked to Yangan Dao. That's his Martian name. Then we had dinner at his home. Very nice. Shish kebab.
What about the story?
Oh, yeah, the story. Well, it seems that he was locked in a room in the city of Scar. And he got out and saw all the dead bodies of the entire Martian population. Then he flew to the capital and saw a button that a priest had pressed, and the next thing he knew, he was inside an Earthman named Howard Wilcox riding a Madison Avenue bus. Want me to write it up?
Is that all you've got to tell me?
That's all. Listen, this guy's going to be perfectly all right as soon as he gets used to the idea that he's Howard Wilcox.
He is, eh? I suppose you're a qualified psychiatrist?
Well, I'm qualified to judge this.
I'd better send Vincent over there.
There's no need for that.
I have a distinct feeling you've let your emotions get into the act.
Well, what's wrong with emotions?
They don't belong in this business.
Look, Cargan, this is a decent enough guy. He's a little bewildered, maybe. Now, why not let him live out his life in peace?
He may be dangerous.
Don't you trust my judgment?
We can't afford to pass up anything important.
Oh, you're exaggerating.
Maybe. Vincent.
Yes, Mr. Cargan.
I want you to do a follow-up on the story that Bill has started. A man named Howard Wilcox, who thinks he's a Martian.
Oh?
Bill has the address.
Now, if anything happens to this guy, there are liable to be questions and accusations.
Vincent can handle that out of it.
You want the full treatment on this story, Mr. Cargan?
If you think the man is a menace, give him the full treatment.
Okay, Mr. Cargan.
I gave Vincent the address, feeling like a murderer, and then I beat it to the nearest phone booth and called Howard Wilcox's home. His wife, Elaine, answered.
Yes?
Well, Mrs. Wilcox, this is Bill Everett again.
Oh, did you forget something?
No, I have something to tell you, and it may sound a little weird, but bear with me.
Oh, what is it?
A man from my newspaper is coming over. His name is Vincent. Now, he's a big, ugly man with a scar on his lip.
He's coming over here.
He's on his way now.
Well, what for?
Well, that's the part you aren't going to believe, Mrs. Wilcox.
Well, try me and see.
He's going to murder your husband.
afraid I didn't hear you.
I said he's coming over to murder your husband.
You and Howard did do quite a bit of drinking.
I'm trying to do you a favor. Now listen to me.
I'm listening.
Send him away. Tell him Howard had to leave town. Do you hear me?
I hear you, but really...
Please, Mrs. Wilcox, if your husband means anything to you...
Of course he does, but why not call the police?
They'll laugh at you. I'm coming right over. I'll explain when I get there. And remember, your husband's life depends on this. I didn't know whether I'd convinced her or not. It all sounded so terribly melodramatic. Anyway, I hopped into a cab and told him to use a heavy foot on the gas pedal, and about 15 minutes later, I arrived at 45 Amber Court.
Oh, it's you.
Was Vincent here?
There was a man here from the Tribune, yes.
Did you do as I told you?
Well, I got Howard out of the house. I sent him out for some mozzarella cheese and gave him a couple of places that don't carry it.
What'd Vincent say?
I told him Howard wouldn't be back in town till tomorrow. He said he'd be back.
Did he say what he wanted?
Just that he had some good news for my husband.
Some good news. May I come in?
I wish you would. I want to know what this is all about. Sit down.
Mm-hmm.
Now, would you mind explaining?
You won't believe me.
You keep saying that.
Okay, Mrs. Wilcox. Your husband, Howard, is a Martian.
A Martian?
That's right.
I see. And when did you discover this about my husband?
This morning.
Would you mind telling me just when he arrived? From Mars, that is.
This morning.
You don't say.
Told you you wouldn't believe me.
Oh, I haven't said that yet. You're sure Howard is a Martian?
Yep. He claims to be the last Martian. Look, see if I can make it clear. There was a plague sweeping Mars. Now, they devised a means of transporting their intellects through space to Earth. Their dead bodies remained behind. Now, Howard, your husband, was confined in an institution, so he didn't get to go with the other Martian souls. He dug his way out and went to the capital city where the energy machine was located.
Mm-hmm.
I guess there was enough left to send his intelligence down here, where it landed in the body of one Howard Wilcox.
How did you find this out?
He told me.
Mr. Everett, if you don't mind, I'm rather tired. First you tell me someone's going to murder Howard, then you tell me he's the man from Mars. Now, I'd like to get some rest, if you don't mind.
I'm trying to convince you your husband is in danger.
If Howard is a Martian, just why does your Mr. Vincent want to kill him?
Because Mr. Vincent is a Martian, too.
Uh-huh. I suppose the editor of the Tribune is also a Martian?
No, not the editor, just the editor of the City Desk.
And you, Mr. Everett... Are you a Martian, too?
Matter of fact, yeah.
Good night.
Just won't see it, will you?
Good night, Mr. Everett.
Okay, I tried my best.
Martians, indeed. Oh, Howard, thank heavens.
I couldn't get the mozzarella.
It doesn't matter. Tell me, Howard, are you a Martian?
What? Why, yes. How did you know?
Oh, woman's intuition. It's terribly late, dear. Let's turn in.
No, not yet. I want to know how you knew I was a Martian.
Howard, please, I've had just about enough of this nonsense today.
It isn't nonsense to me. Only this morning I was Yang Gandal, a Martian. Now I'm in the body of your husband.
Is this a joke you and your friend Mr. Everett invented to torture me? Because if it is...
It isn't a joke. It's the truth.
Howard, I just can't stand much more of this. I'm beginning to wonder if it's me. Who could that be at this hour?
I'll answer it. Yes?
You are Mr. Howard Wilcox?
Yes?
My name is Vincent. I'm a reporter from the Trib.
Yes?
May I come in?
Yes.
Who is... Oh, Mr. Vincent.
I see your husband has unexpectedly returned from out of town, Mrs. Wilcox.
Now, look here.
Would you mind telling me why you lied to me?
Yes, I would.
Does it have anything to do with the fact that you know your husband's secret?
What secret?
That he is Yangan Dao, a Martian.
But I don't know what you're talking about.
I think you do.
Why is there such concern? I am Yangan Dao. I am a Martian. The last Martian, as far as I know.
That is where you're wrong, Mr. Wilcox.
Wrong?
You see, there are many of us.
Many? Like me?
Hundreds of thousands. We were teleported to Earth during the Great Migration and found ourselves, like you, inside human beings.
But then I'm not alone. You do understand my position.
Perfectly.
I can establish contact. We can remember our old home.
Unfortunately, no.
I don't understand.
Sadly enough, young Endowell, you were considered mentally ill on Mars. Ill enough so that you were institutionalized.
But
here on Earth, a person like you represents a distinct threat to us.
How do I threaten you?
You're unstable. You may give us away. That would spoil it.
Spoil what?
Our plan.
Plan?
You have not heard of the plan?
I heard of no plan. I was in an institution.
Yes. You are certain now?
Of course. What plan?
If you knew, I would have been forced to destroy you. You've just saved your own life, young and doll, and that of Howard Wilcox as well.
What are you going to do?
Nothing. Nothing at all.
Aren't you afraid that I'll do something?
Such as?
Tell people my husband is a Martian.
Really, Mrs. Wilcox, you know better. You'd be laughed at or sent to the nearest psychiatric clinic. No, we aren't at all concerned with the fact that people will betray our presence here on Earth. I'm sure you can appreciate the reaction if you were to phone the police and tell them that the Trib reporters are all Martians.
Well, not all. Just the city editor and yourself and Mr. Everett.
How did you know that?
Perhaps I'm one myself, Mr. Vincent.
It isn't possible.
Why not?
Are you? Tell me where you were born. What city?
I was born in Undanel near the dead canal of Krilla.
Your name?
Zanat Cree.
You are party to the plan?
The plan to take over the Earth? Of course.
Your husband, Young and Dahl, why did you not inform him?
For the same reason you did not. He is unstable. But there is no need to worry. I will care for him.
Amazing.
Now, would you mind leaving us alone? We have many things to discuss.
Of course. Amazing. Positively amazing.
I was standing in Barney's bar having a double scotch on the rocks when Vincent came in looking like a man who spent the last 3 hours in a KitchenAid mixer with the dial on Fluffy. He came over and ordered without so much as a look at me.
Here it is, Mr. Vincent.
Thanks.
You okay?
Sure.
By the way, did you fellas take care of that crackpot who was in here this afternoon, the one who thought he was a Martian?
Sure.
Just a drunk, huh?
Yeah, that's right. Wouldn't you say so, Bill?
Oh, definitely.
Well, here's to you, Barney. Sometimes you can't tell the Martians from the Earthmen. You know?
It's getting to be that way, Mr. Vincent. Right, Bill?
That's right, Barney. Integration. That's what it is. I gave Barney a sly wink and lifted my glass along with Vincent. Of course, Barney understood. You see, he's one of us, too.
You have just heard X-1, presented by the National Broadcasting Company in cooperation with Galaxy Science Fiction Magazine, which this month features Alan Cogan's story, Nothing But the Best, which tells about a strange mix-up in time and place. Galaxy Magazine, on your newsstand today. Tonight, by transcription, X-1 has brought you The Last Martian, a story from the pages of Galaxy written by Frederick Brown
and adapted for radio by George Lefferts. Featured in the cast were Mandel Kramer, Elliot Reed, Santos Ortega, Ralph Bell, John McGovern, and Patricia Wheel. Your announcer, Fred Collins. X-1 was directed by Daniel Sutter and is an NBC Radio Network production.
Go to the conventions with NBC Radio beginning Monday, August 13th.
Hi, this is Bob Hastings. Just telling you that you should be listening to Glowing Dial with Big John and Steve. Don't miss it. It's fun.
And we're back, folks. Hope you enjoyed X-1. That was The Last Martian from Tuesday, August 7th, 1956, originally over NBC. And you know what? That's four shows that aired on Stu's birthday.
The Last Martian. Isn't that lovely? I claim the show in the name of Mars.
You need your explosive plutonium space modulator.
Where's the kaboom?
Sorry, I just, Last Martian.
An earth-shattering kaboom.
That episode had a nice twist ending, kind of, too. I like that show, that series.
Oh, yeah.
But
well,
anyway.
All the Warner Brothers stuff was pretty good. Even some of the Metro stuff. When Tex Avery went over to Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer.
Oh, yeah.
He did something. I showed it to you one night when we were at the DJ convention.
Yep.
It's called Symphony and Slang. And it's all these bad one-liners and sight gags. And
is that where you get them from?
No, that's not exactly where I got them from. It's just when I saw it, I'm going, that's my humor.
Yeah, yeah.
Like when I saw Airplane.
It was inspired.
Which is 35 years old now.
I know. Isn't that scary?
35th anniversary for the movie Airplane, if anybody remembers that.
I remember seeing that at the movie. Yeah, yeah.
I saw that and I said, that's my humor. That's my kind of jokes. And I should have gotten paid for writing some of those with those guys.
Police Squad.
In color.
Yep. You got to say
Rex
that.
Hamilton as Abraham Lincoln.
And that was the last you saw of him. Yeah, it was great. I like how the guest stars all died at the beginning and you saw them for about 2 seconds.
Can you name all six guest stars?
No. No, I can't. I remember
Bill Shatner, Warren Green. Okay, I remember two of them. I haven't seen the show in a while.
And Rex Hamilton as Abraham Lincoln.
Six episodes is all it lasted because people had to watch it.
Yeah, yeah.
They didn't, leaving it on for background noises wasn't good enough. You had to watch it and watch it carefully because they threw all kinds of stuff in.
Oh, the sight gags were priceless, too. I always liked the endings when they'd freeze. They'd have the freeze ending, and it wasn't really. And there was one especially good one where they're in the station, police station, and the guy starts pouring a glass of a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
And everyone freezes, and the coffee keeps pouring, and it goes everywhere. It's really awesome. It's dumb stuff like that.
I think the average TV audience didn't understand what they were trying to do with that show, So.
Yeah.
I did, and appreciated it, but.
It's funny how humor seems to only work on the radio in the mornings. And at night on sitcoms. Isn't that weird about how the human psyche works?
Yeah. Well, there's morning shows on the radio. There's no drive time shows, per se.
Yep.
Like there is in the morning. Like Dick Purton.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyone in the Detroit area might remember Dick Purton?
Purton's People.
Yes. Way back in Keener 13. Then he went to CKLW in Windsor, Canada. And it was WOMC, I think.
I like Jim Harper, too. Harper in the Morning. They had a cast.
It used to be Harper, Gannon,
characters.
And you.
Yep, yep. Yeah.
And again, anybody listening to us outside of the Detroit area is going, who? Who? Who?
Yeah. Like I say, we Michiganiacs are a parochial bunch.
They're saying
it's all about us.
Who? Which is our favorite doctor.
That's right. There's the Red Wings and the other hockey teams.
Mm-hmm.
There's the Tigers and the other baseball teams. Of course, then there's the Lions, the best losers in football.
Yeah.
See, that's how we Detroiters say, we have the best, most losingest team in football.
There's you forgot the Pistons.
Well, the Pistons,
basketball.
They've actually won a couple of times. Yeah, they've actually done pretty good. So,
Well, we are out of time, folks.
Aren't you glad?
Oh,
it's
yeah.
finally over. Those guys are going to shut up now.
Until 3 weeks from now, or roughly, depending on when you're listening to this program.
Yes.
You could be listening to it in the archives. I don't know.
You
if don't. You are, you need to catch up and keep current with us.
Keep current with the old stuff.
There's a preserves joke in there somewhere, and keep current.
Yeah.
Ringo, I miss you. All right.
Yeah, it's about time we marmalade our way out of this show, though.
Yeah, we'll be in a real jam if we don't.
Yep.
Music in the background says it's time for those closing reminders, folks.
Wish those smuckers would shut up.
I have one, but I'm not going to do it.
I know, you can't.
Don't forget that chicken man set. You know you want one. You got to have one.
Oh,
just
I
look for
one.
Those silly dancing chickies on our homepage. There we go. That's what I was looking for last time. Don't forget the Glowing Dial online store. Plenty of great gift ideas with the Glowing Dial logo and more being designed at this very moment, more or less. Don't forget the Glowing Dial bookstore, which is through Amazon.com, and a great way to support the Glowing Dial. Anything you purchase there, anything you're to purchase through Amazon.com, go through our page so we get some support out of that. Join our blog, our discussion list, and Facebook page and get all the latest Glowing Dial news. Don't forget the celebrity birthdays. There's much more than we can present in this program at our buddy Ron Sales' blog, and the link for that is on the Glowing Dial page. Jerry Handigas has audio restoration services that we'd like to let you know about. Clean up those old recordings or transcription discs if you'd like. Jerry can help you out with that. Jerry Handigas also has his old-time radio network where you can hear the Glowing Dial, Jerry's own show, and many other old-time radio shows in streaming audio. And, of course, a great big thank you goes out to Jerry Handigas for his programming assistance in this and many episodes of Glowing Dial. And last but not least, the Glowing Dial page, which has been the internet home of the Glowing Dial since 1997. Yes, all those years ago.
Yeah.
Sound like George Harrison.
Hey.
Has links for all the things we just mentioned there.
Yeah,
a list of past shows.
It's also old enough to drink.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow, is it? Wow.
Yeah, I know.
It's been that long.
Goes by when you're having fun, doesn't it?
Yes, we started the show and we were just toddlers, me and Steve.
Yeah, toddlers at 30 or whatever.
It was so long ago, Steve actually had hair in his head. Yes.
I think he's still got a couple.
Two.
Yeah, yeah.
But he uses that thickening agent, so, you know.
They're on his chin.
Makes it look... Steve, we're just kidding. If you're listening, we want you back.
Last time Steve felt hair is when he got a hole in his pocket.
And on that note, folks...
That's arable, by the way. I heard that on you.
Yeah,
I stole
okay,
that.
Don't report us to the FCC or anything. This is Big John and Stu say, keep a positive thought, keep looking up, and think big, and we'll see you on the radio.
All right.
Bye.